Hey YouTube, how you guys doing today? Today we're gonna be watching all Kobe cook some shit, and we're gonna watch Daniel Larson and Hygiene from Rogue Internet Man, and then we're gonna watch some Chris. Old Chris.
I've been making this crazy custom pizza pie here, and well, I need to put a couple of the ingredients on. There's gonna be a little bit of pre-cooking involved, which won't take too long. 12 delicious patties, ready to go. Well, here's our pie crust that we're gonna need for later. There we go, beautiful. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna you cut it long.
What the fuck does he need a potato and a fucking a graham cracker pie crust for? I gotta see this shit. I wonder what vile boglim slop he's gonna make today.
One this way, and then you cut it, flip it over, and then cut it
Hey
long
Andy, how you doing today?
the other way. So go down this way, flip it over, go down this way. Actually, no, I want to use a different knife because this one's.
Hey Deidre, how you doing?
Yeah.
Oh, you're at the park with your kid? That's cool. Them playgrounds are a lot safer than when we were kids, man. When we were kids, they had like the jungle bars over a fucking asphalt fucking ground and shit. Now they've got them cut up tires and all that, nice soft stuff to fall on so you don't chip your teeth off. You know what I mean?
Yeah, the right tools for the job. All right. So the reason why I'm filming this pre-cook process
Hey Star, how you doing?
is so you can kind of see what I'm doing here before too long. Now, see what happens when you cut them the long way twice? You get these nice little French fry shapes, just like that. Beautiful. I'm gonna call it making a pizza.
I want to get one too. Anybody that likes to make homemade French fries out of potatoes really needs one of them things like they have at In-N-Out. You know, the ones that you put the potato in it and then you have the shit and you push it out of the other end and stuff. I really want to get one of those, and they're only like $20. I think I'm gonna get one soon.
To pie. People are gonna look at it and go, oh, it's the same shitty cooks on almost every video. Who cares? You don't like it, don't watch. Let the haters talk smack. They're not worth your time, you know?
Yep, I know people that lost teeth and shit like that, broke arms. Times were rough. They didn't give a shit about us 80s kids.
All that YouTube. You know what? I'll keep the video going while I do it on the phone. That way you can get it from different angles. That'll make the fans happy. What is up, fellow YouTubers? It's your Casper Bad Boy back at you with another video. And right now we're making a pizza pie, literally. There are a couple of ingredients I wanted to like pre-cook before actually making the pie. And I did some of the pre-cooking stuff on another video, which I'm still filming right there. Hey, double videos. All right, so I'm gonna unplug the phone. Now, in this here pizza pie, we're going to use this as the crust, literal graham cracker crust, because why not? I'm going to throw in some taters and some beef and some bacon, some pork rinds, some Doritos, some of those cheesy cheese puff jalapeno stuffs, some pepperoni, some cheese, some sauce. Who knows how it's going to taste, but
Hey Kibble, how you doing? I can't complain. I got smoke and cigarettes, so it's always a good day when you got that.
to find out. Now I got a burger patty cooked up for the pie. I guess these are ready to go as well. And before I fry up these French fries for the pie, how do you cut them to make them look like French fries? You cut them going down the potato, and then you flip it over and do the same thing. And when you do that, you're gonna get these longer cube-shaped classic French fry shape. Yeah, I'm gonna leave the skin on them just because.
I could ration the like 3/4 of an ounce that I have and make it last for 2 weeks, but that's not my personality. That shit's gonna be gone in 4 or 5 days.
I was feeling lazy and yeah. All right, so now we got our burger patty cooked up. We're gonna turn the stove back up to 8 and get our oven preheated. Let's go with 420 degrees. And there we go. That'll get our oven on the preheat so that way when we go to stick the pie
Does
in.
he actually like? I think he just makes this shit up as he goes, is what I think he does when he cooks.
It'll be ready to go.
So now we got some of this Black Label thick cut bacon from Hormel. And we're going to open it up and we're going to...
I'm not big on bacon as a pizza topping. I don't like it. It's not very good. I don't know. Just something about the two flavors, they don't mesh right.
Get ourselves a couple pieces and drop it in the pan. Fry it up real quick. Okay, that bacon's done. We're going to transfer it to our...
I thought he was about to put some of the damn dish soap in his food.
Chronic plates. So we got a little bit of grease going in there with that bacon grease, but we're just going to add a little bit of vegetable oil. That way we're not completely... Yeah. Kind of going like that. And a little bit more. There we go. We don't need a whole lot for these, just a little bit. But now all those potatoes we chopped up, we're going to throw them in the pan. We're going to add a little bit of butter to this mixture. Just like that. A couple cubes of butter there. And right now I'm just taking this butter and spreading it all over the potatoes. You like French fries? You put a little bit of salt on these after you're done cooking them. There you go.
You know what's really good to add to your oil whenever you make French fries? Crisco, if you add, you know, like about 4 or 5 tablespoons to a deep fryer, it makes everything better, but you know, makes everything have a lot more saturated fat too. You know what I mean?
And you think just because it's homemade, you think, oh, it's going to be super difficult. No. Last time I tried to make homemade French fries, they were a disaster, but I learned a couple of tricks from some friends of mine who know how to cook. And I'm going to take the knowledge that I've learned and apply it to a cooking video so I can share the knowledge. Because knowledge is power, YouTube. Knowledge is power. Hold on a second.
There we go. Pick up the camera. Bah!
I have the fork and the camera in the same phone. The fork and the camera in the same hand. Yeah, I meant to say hand, not phone, but there you go.
I'll agree with Cobra there. Knowledge is power. Which is a very good thing. Like in India and them villages and shit, they're getting like, they're giving them tablets with solar chargers, you know, and then they can go on the internet and look up all kinds of college books and shit like that. So it's going to be a lot better mind, you know, instead of having 4 billion minds working on shit, we'll have 8 billion minds looking on shit, you know, and there'll still be about 1 billion people that live in shit places that, you know, nobody knows or cares about.
Anyways, YouTube, this is how you do it. A nice thing about homemade French fries, not only are they super easy to make, but holy crap, are they cheap. Potatoes are not expensive, man. And that's the nice thing about it. So take a look. Let's take a look here and see what we got. Oh. Oh, my God. Oh. Oh. Oh.
Where's the salt? Where's the pepper? What's wrong with you, Cobra? Those are fucking French fries.
But then, and they're a little bit crispy on the outside. But nice and chewy on the inside. Nope. No, you get a big get back here. These homemade fries are the bomb. We need to get our pie crust going. So now we're going to take our pie crust and start filling it with stuff. We need...
If I see him put that peanut butter I seen on a counter in there, I'm going to fucking scream.
Pepperonis. We need some cheese. And we need the sauce.
I hate the way he says mozzarella. Watch, he's going to say it. I know he is.
Running out of space here on this counter, so I'm going to put some of it over here. We'll start off with a little bit of sauce. Some of this Prego roasted garlic parmesan. And you don't need a whole lot. Just a little bit to kind of put on the bottom here. Kind of dab it on there just a little bit. Just like that. Now we're going to add pepperonis to these pepperonis right here. Big old slices of pepperoni. So now we're going to begin the very painstaking process of layering it. It's right there. It's going to be a labor of love, YouTube. All right, so
you don't layer shit with pepperonis, man. You spread them out like evenly and not a lot of them because they'll grease up the crust and make your pizza gross.
Now we have all of our pepperonis in there just like that. Let's add some more sauce. Just like that.
Hey, Sinister, how you doing?
That's, I'm going to add just like, okay, maybe like a little bit more. Right. There we go. Okay. Now we need to add some other stuff to it.
Yeah, he talks fast. Nasty Bastard just farted on air. But anyway, he talks faster because I think it's from it is from a couple years ago whenever his brain wasn't destroyed by Duster that he huffs. How lame to dust? That is lame, dude. You're fucking lame if you sniff glue or some shit like that. That's a stupid ass way to get high.
Excuse me, I farted. We got the Hers jalapeno poppers. Not gender based, just the name of the company. And I want to take and I want to crush them up. Okay, there's those six Cheetos crushed up right there. Kind of maybe some pork rinds. Now on top of our chips, we're going to add some potatoes. We'll put a couple on here so you can, and then we'll show you what it looks like before we finish doing other stuff to it. Is this pie going to be healthy? No, pie is usually never healthy.
I've got a bowl packed and I got like four other bowls in front of me that I like to break up a lot of weed at one time, you know, and then just kind of use it throughout the course of the day. I used to have a friend and his homegrown, he'd break it all up and turn it into powder. And then it'd be getting old after like 3 months. He's like, why is it getting old? It's like, cause you turned it into fucking powder. You should have left it as buds.
To be fair. I want to add bacon on top of these potatoes. Okay, here's that pie so far. With all the bacon and the taters piled up on top there. We'll do another layer of sauce on top, but we don't need a whole lot of it, though. Just a little bit more on top. What's a pizza without some mozzarella?
I don't know, man. It seems like some people are blessed with that because always, every seed I start, starts. Like, very rarely one seed won't start. And I'm not using anything special. I just used a lot of times I've been so broke that I'd steal a fucking paper towel out of a bathroom at like a gas station and use that. And I still have 10 of them come up out of 10. You know what I mean?
Mozzarella.
I'm lucky.
Pizza cheese.
And whenever they're in the paper towel, you open up the paper towel every few hours to give them a little air. That's another big secret that most people don't know. And you don't put any peroxide because the fucking plants don't need that shit. Anyone who says to do that is an idiot. You're just going to burn the fucking new roots with the peroxide.
Let's put the beef on top of the bacon. That's what I'm feeling for this recipe. I'm going to take our beef and tear it up into tiny little chunks. 1 second, YouTube. I got to show the other camera real quick. Okay, so this is what our pie looks like so far. It's looking pretty good. Oh, YouTube. Take a look at that. Oh, yeah. Now we're talking. Now we're wrong.
Yeah, not even often. Like, you know, even every like 8 hours or something like that's fine. That's how often you want to give them a little air. And what I do is I don't get them super wet so it chokes the roots, and then I just put it in a Ziploc bag, you know, and then I open up the bag and air them out every now and then. That's the way I've always done it. It works pretty good. Yeah, that's what I do. As soon as it cracks a little bit of white and you can see the tip of the root still inside the seed, that's when I put them in dirt, and they always come up. The thing is you just keep the little spot in the middle where you put it wet, extra wet for a few days.
Now we're going to add a sprinkle of cheese on top. Wait, cheese? What is this, cheesecake? I thought it was a pie. Okay, there's my bad joke for the video. Ignore that one. Six of pepperonis.
Yeah, seeds are completely legal now because of the 2018 Farm Bill. It doesn't matter what state you live in, you can order seeds. I know a lot of people do it, but I'm telling you right now, don't start a bag seed, because in that room where they grew that fucking chronic at, there was no male. It only came from a hermaphrodite. And while that doesn't guarantee that the female that comes out is going to be a hermaphrodite, it's still just better to buy feminized seeds that you know is going to be a female. You know, that's how I do it.
On top.
Because, I mean, what's $50 for good seeds, you know, that you know are going to be like 20%, 25% bud, you know what I mean? And, you know, when you get like, even if you cut clones, you could grow pounds of it. You know what I mean?
Put it on top of our our cheese. I don't know if I call this baking. I don't know what the heck you'd call it. Like next level cooking is what I'd call it. And they want to eat one on camera because I can't.
I always had a friend that take the seed pods off. I never do. They always break out of the seed pod. You know, they break out of the seed. I've never taken it off in my life. One time one was stuck on there pretty good, but as soon as I touched it, I just touched the seed thing. It fell off. So in a couple hours, the plant would have knocked it off.
And I'm just going to take a couple of these French. And you know what? I'm just going to. Yeah. Could we? Should we? Why not? Let's do one.
Oh, that's cool, Andy. Yeah, there's still cool people out there.
More sprinkle of cheese on top, but not a very big one. It's enough to, you know, we are ready to go, yo. So what I want to do is I want to turn the oven on to timer. Let's bake it for 20 minutes and see how it looks after that. And now, YouTube, I should do a couple things here real quick. Now that our pie's in the oven. I noticed the countertop at the side of the stove is a little bit messy, so.
I like the Sonic the Hedgehog ones from the 90s. Those are really good.
Hear that real quick? That's just part of cooking. You gotta clean up after you're done. Cooking the food, eating the food. Cooking and eating the food are the best parts. Nobody likes the cleanup, but a good chef will always clean up after their cooking mess. And that's just common fucking knowledge, man. Pardon my French, YouTube, but I'm just saying. Little kids shouldn't be cussing, even if they hear adults do it. I know it's hypocritical, believe me, I know. But that's just beside the point. Well, anywho, tubes, I want to end the video over here on this part right here on the QuickTime player. Yeah.
I always liked the Bomb Pop as a kid because the Bomb Pop was like the best bang for your buck. You know what I mean? It was one of the cheapest, but it was also one of the biggest.
Ending.
Or that video ends, this one continues. If kids want to cuss, they should use kid-friendly cuss words like butt cheese and poopy breath and, you know, booger brains.
I didn't have enough money to grab soda pop at the store, but that's all right.
The tantalizingly delicious taste of nacho cheese Doritos.
Skip that can. Well, no, you don't. Stay right there.
Now, when you're taking stuff out of the oven, you don't want to burn your hands because that would hurt. So, whenever you're taking hot stuff out of the oven.
Oh, yeah, I still buy the Haagen-Dazs strawberry cheesecake ones I buy them at Walmart sometimes. I like them. I don't get them all the time, though. I'm the kind of person who gets burnt out on shit. You know what I mean? Like, I'll buy a certain type of ice cream, and then I won't want that kind of ice cream for 6 months kind of person.
Make sure you have a nice pair of oven mitts to keep your hands protected.
Those Rocky Road ice cream sandwiches were good, too. The Mississippi Muds, I haven't seen those in a while.
I can't say I'm not happy with the way that turned out. Because I'm not going to lie, YouTube, that looks pretty.
Yeah, he's got wonky eyes. He had a surgery for it, Coves, but he didn't keep up with his fucking training, and it's wonky again. And I guarantee it's like the martial artist one where you stand like a pencil straight in front of your face, and then you slowly move it out of your vision and then back to your vision while following it with your eye, and that'll that can help straighten out sometimes if they're not bad. And it can, in his case, it would have kept his eye from going back to like that.
Freaking good. I'll set that down, let that cool off. Okay, I gotta show a close-up of this pie here. Look at that, YouTube. Doesn't that just look delicious? Let's give it a cut. I probably should have, damn it. The bottom of the crust just completely fell apart. Son of a bitch. I mean, the concept of it was a good idea. Don't get me wrong. But, yeah, that didn't stay together like I thought it would. Was going to, unfortunately. That's alright, though, YouTube. We're still gonna eat it. Well, YouTube, I'll give myself props for trying. It's an original recipe. Just have ourselves a slice of it now.
Live and let learn, I suppose, as the age-old expression goes.
That's what I have to say, YouTube is son of a pickle-licking, toad-sniffing butt cheese. But that's all right. We're still going to eat it because you never know, it might taste good. I don't think we can cut into it. Let's just take a bite out of it. Despite the fact that the crust fell apart, this is pretty good. A bit of a cooking disaster, but it still tastes good. Right there, you can see that cross section. This turned out pretty good. Well, I cleaned the plate. That's how you know it's good. Anyways, tubes, thanks for watching. And I know for a fact there's got to be some way to bake that crust with the ingredients so it doesn't fall apart. And I might have missed that step somewhere, but that's all right. That's all right. Boom. Pizza pie.
What strain is your dab? I like dabs. They're all right. But for some reason, I feel like flower gives you a more full high. I'm not completely sure that there's I'm pretty sure there's a chemical in weed that gets you high that they haven't discovered yet. Because sometimes you'll smoke some 18% weed and it'll get you higher than the shit they said was 30. You know what I mean?
I'm going to be honest with you. I really don't know how to start this video off. Usually, I try to start with some sort of semi-neutral starting point that can be used to quickly move the conversation toward the introduction of the main topic. However, I don't think there's really any clever way to introduce this video's star. I have received plenty of requests to look at the story of Daniel Larson, and I'm still kicking myself in the butt for having joined the Danderson train so late. But better late than never, right? At first, I wanted to make a large, all-encompassing video covering his lengthy story and all of the greatest freakouts from him, but plenty of people have already put out long-form content on the topic and have covered essentially everything there is to say, not to mention that...
That poor bag, it's seen Cyrax beat off a million times. I feel sad for that Doritos bag. It just needs to be put out of its misery at this point. It's scarred forever.
He is still very active online. Until his story slows down or comes to a close, it'd be difficult to give a full synopsis of everything. However, I think it'd be worthwhile to pick particular parts of his life, such as his hygiene and health, and focus solely on them to give a concise and researched explanation as to what the hell is actually going on with everyone's favorite transient. Today, we'll be looking into Daniel's declining health and lack of hygiene, a topic that surely won't be disgusting or depressing. Let's get right into it.
Oh, hell yeah. Wedding cake was good, so it's probably that wedding cake crosses something or like... F2 wedding cake, you know, some shit like that.
If you click this video, you more than likely have a cursory knowledge of Daniel and his traits, notably his lack of a house. Daniel is currently homeless and likely will be for the...
Well, yeah, but if you get some 30% bud, you know, you just... Three hits is one hit of the concentrate, you know what I mean? Three hits isn't a lot. Just roll up a joint. I like the joint the best, but I smoke out of the bong more because smoking out of the bong gets rid of a lot of the tar and it cools the smoke down. And that's what's really bad for you about smoking and shit. You're breathing like 300-400 degree smoke into your lungs.
Foreseeable future, thanks to his increasingly erratic behavior. Due to his lack of housing, his access to running water is only in limited quantities, as he relies solely on commercial establishments or free drinking water that is available at parks or transit stations. His lack of water intake has undoubtedly been a contributing factor to his health, and we've seen how he's physically begun to falter. Overall, his diet is far less than acceptable. The only notable foods and drinks he seems to consume...
I hate Jack Herer. Everyone is like, oh, I love Jack Herer. I love the taste. I think the taste is fucking disgusting.
Are macaroni and cheese, chips, like obviously nachos, candy, sugary drinks like soda, and sports drinks.
Yeah, my dad uses the raw cones too because he can't roll because his wrist is fucked up from doing construction. He kept swinging that stupid metal S-wing hammer whenever he should have been using a wooden hammer. If you work construction, use a damn wooden hammer. yeah, you got to hit a little harder. Boo-hoo.
He's in absolutely no fruits or vegetables or straight water. Everything that he eats is loaded up with sugar and salt, providing next to no nutritional value, if any at all. Despite having some access to water, such as purchasing a cheap bottle of...
Oh, yeah, I like a good vape cart sometimes. I like... I got from California the cookies. One of them was Space Queen, and then there was another one that I can't remember, and that shit was really good. There's good vapes. I don't dislike vapes. I just like smoking the weed better.
Drinking water or possibly bottling some from a nearby water fountain, he refuses to utilize any that he may come across for bathing. Grant.
Well, if weed's legal in your state, Humboldt Seed Company sells seeds for it, man. You know, they sell train wreck seeds because they're in Humboldt. That's where train wreck's from. So I would assume it's probably pretty good train wreck, you know.
It would be hard to bathe using water limited to the capacity of a bottle. It would still be preferable than using absolutely nothing. He could, at the very least, wash his private areas, face, in his hair. Despite being a vagrant, Daniel has had some temporary housing that inevitably fell through due to his openly nonsensical behavior. This obviously further restricts his access to running water, cleaning products, and a toilet to properly crap in. During his limited stays at shelters and people's homes, he would often refuse to bathe. This has caused some trouble between him and his adoring audience, as they continue to encourage him to, at the bare minimum, stand under a running shower and let the grease get washed out of his hair. When fans finally pressured him enough, he got his belly full of the complaints and attempted to appease his legion of fans, but not actually by showering, thus not actually taking care of himself, but rather by recording himself near a shower where running water can be heard. Every time he's claimed to have bathed, he never appears to be wet afterward. Getting damp at the minimum is part of showering, unless I've been doing it wrong. I'll have to give that one more thought. When Daniel was living with Jonas, his former caretaker, Daniel was convinced to finally clean himself up. This bathing session, which happened on the 7th of July 2022, was the only evidence I could find of him bathing until November of 2023. There were likely a handful of times he bathed between those dates, but I also like to assume that it's just a yearly occurrence for him. Foul, but hilarious nonetheless. On May 23, 2023, Daniel shared that he hadn't bathed since 2022. Could it be from July of that year or sooner than that? Either way, you know he stank bad, as opposed to stinking good. I really don't want to consider what that entails. Daniel livestreamed to YouTube on November 16, 2023, where he kept the camera face down so the viewers couldn't see anything going on. He turned on a bathtub faucet and let the water run for at least 33 minutes and 4 seconds. The duration could be longer as the water was already running as the stream had started. You know he didn't pay for that water, so it fell on whoever owned the property. He also didn't appear to have bathed either, so it was just a gigantic waste of time to prove nothing. After the water stopped running, the stream went mostly silent for the rest of its duration up until about the 42-minute mark when Daniel can be heard reading nasty stream chat comments and conversing with the man who he alleged to be Bob, with the broadcast ending at about 55 minutes and 40 seconds.
The fuck? He's just running the faucet. No, I'm not. What the fuck? New soap, no rag. Man, why is there so much fucking hate? Holy crap.
Why is there so much hate? Daniel, because it's a constant in every place in the world. Everyone wants you to take a bath every day. Doesn't matter where you live. Doesn't matter who you are. Because, you know, and you don't take a bath every day, you know, you start to smell like onions and shit. Especially if you eat a lot of garlic.
Got a car horn. Taking a shower outside. What the fuck? Alrighty. Alrighty. Man, that was a good shower. Alrighty.
It's probable that Daniel has some sort of hydrophobia, or he just finds water to be an unpleasant sensation on his skin. This could be caused by autism, which appears to be a pervasive part of his personality that affects almost every facet of his life. Simply put, if he had less things affecting his head, this wouldn't be happening. But you really don't need me to tell you that. What bewilders me is how he seems to be totally fine with having dirt caked onto his skin, nestling deep into his pores. He also doesn't seem to mind having greasy hair. Seriously, that hair looks like you could grab some strands of it, wring it out like a washcloth, and save the oil that leaks out to fry some food with later. How does that not feel awful against his skin? Unless he likes that sort of thing. Another factor here is that Daniel is also incredibly lazy. I'm not saying this to be mean, but I'm just being honest. In his position, at his age, he should be in his prime. This is the point in his life where he should be carving out a nice slice of the world.
Yeah, it's funny. Whenever he does his little lives, you don't get to see how small his weird little head is and the nothing that's going on between these two eyes. He weighs 119 pounds, so he's even smaller than he looks. Like, if he was an actual t-shirt and there's a picture someone took of him, he'd look super scrawny.
For himself, in order to provide for his own well-being, and also to build the foundation for a healthy adult life. Instead of doing this, he's content fawning over a girl he's been chasing since she was underage, and because he also wants to chase a career in music. I'm not 100% sure on this, but I really doubt a singer-songwriter would go weeks without bathing. I don't recall seeing any dirty goblins on the red carpet while watching the boob tube. Actually, no, I take it back, they all are. Anyway, maybe I'm expecting too much from somebody who is severely suffering from mental illness. Oh well. On January 7th, 2024, Daniel finally elaborated as to why he refuses to bathe. He claims that because he only has one set of clothing and he has no home or way to clean them, that bathing would be redundant as his clothes are already filthy. I don't really get his logic here. I'd argue that doing something is better than nothing. Wash your fucking hair at least.
I don't have any other clothes. I would be putting on the same clothes, so I'm not going to shower if I put on the same clothes. And I'm not going to shower if I'm going to be right back out on the streets getting dirty. It makes no sense.
It's worth mentioning that because of his difficulty maintaining housing, he is eligible to stay at homeless shelters. In a situation where you do not have a house and you need a place to stay, given the circumstances, there is nothing wrong with utilizing the facilities available to you at a shelter. Daniel wastes this opportunity, as many shelters provide bathrooms for people to clean up and take care of their business. Despite this, he opts to not bathe. Instead, public bathrooms are more of a place for him to take care of himself in other ways. He uses them to sleep and masturbate. There, I said it. Figured I'd just rip the band-aid right off. Any bathroom he enters should be scrubbed thoroughly to remove any organic materials that he may have left behind. The filth that collected on his skin, and still does, built up enough and introduced yet another hazard for him in early 2023. At this time, Daniel reported having really itchy rashes on his skin. Given his bathing regimen, this is to be expected. However, this happened while he was moseying around in California, not taking care of his hygiene, wearing the same clothes every single day, and sleeping in portable shitters at night. Yes, this man slept in stinky, revolting, filthy porta-potties. I think I'd rather sleep on a fucking curb. Turns out Daniel had, and I really wouldn't doubt if he still had this problem, a bad case.
Well, yeah, Mr. E, but Daniel's not the kind of homeless person that's, you know, just homeless for a minute and he's trying to get along with it, you know what I mean? Daniel's the, I'm too lazy to help myself, you know, please donate to my cash. You know what I mean? He's that kind of homeless person. You know what I mean?
Case of scabies. Scabies is an infection of small mites burrowing into the skin of a person or animal. He would often show off his rash in both live streams and videos, which of course was an incredibly foolish move on his part as he posed a risk for spreading the infection to other people who were unknowingly being subjected to his shit. Scabies can spread very easily, and when it does, it moves very fast. While Daniel was dealing with his newfound pets, he actually went down to Disneyland and rode a few rides and wandered around the park, undoubtedly spreading the infection to other people. Because of his diagnosis and idiotic oversharing, a Facebook post was made for Anaheim residents, letting people know Daniel was walking around with mites in his skin, frequenting places like Disneyland and Panera Bread. The post had several photos of him and his self-taken scabies shots. Normally, I'd say that using this kind of method to incite normies to react is unnecessary, but then again, he was essentially committing bioterrorism by just walking around. He knew exactly what he was doing, plus, he was taking photos of kids, and that needed to come to a stop anyway. He didn't need to go to places where children are present to begin with. Daniel tried to solve the infestation by seeking medical help only after his fans pressured him to do so. After he received a formal diagnosis for scabies and a prescription for expensive lotion, Daniel whined about the cost of the remedy. Stupid people unfortunately handed over the cash, for some reason deciding to help a vile pedo fork. And of course, he just wasted the money on sweets from the Cheesecake Factory. Maybe people shouldn't give out cash so freely. Obviously, the itchiness persisted, only getting worse as time passed. Eventually, it became too much for him and he returned to the hospital, where a nurse gave him some ivermectin and cleaned him up with a washcloth. That poor, poor nurse. I'd quit on the spot if I had to handle him. And I'd argue that, out of all the people in the world who deserve to get a sponge bath from a nurse, Daniel...
Man, I went to Disneyland. I wish I would have hung on to the five $1 bills and two $5 bills that I got while I was there. Because them Disney bucks are worth some fucking cash now.
The least deserving. Because of the nurse's assistance, Daniel bid adieu to his buggy friends. It's likely he still has them or he will get scabies again in the future, so for any of you mouth-breathing idiots that actually want to make contact with him and intend to take a photo with the creep, perhaps decide against it. You're better than that, and you really don't want mites digging into your flesh.
Oh, so I was just given a pill to get rid of these scabies all over me. It was nice knowing you, friends. Now you're all dead. Nice knowing you. Goodbye.
However, this was not the only time his lack of hygiene has negatively impacted his overall health. A lack of bathing and clean laundry can present a variety of different illnesses and health deficits. Daniel was hit by one particular one you likely wouldn't expect. Trench foot. Don't worry, Daniel wasn't crawling around in the flooded trenches during a military skirmish. He was fighting the real battle, being a homeless, schizophrenic, freeloading degenerate. As we have all come to understand at this point, Daniel will go weeks to months without even doing as much as changing his clothes. He's constantly exposed to the elements such as moisture in the air, rain, snow, and everything else in between, not to mention his own sweat. As such, when his socks get soggy, it makes his skin prune up. He apparently wasn't aware that long-term exposure to moisture can do significant damage to one's skin, particularly feet. Trenchfoot features a variety of unpleasant symptoms such as pain, swelling, poor circulation, numbness, and even tingling or prickly sensations. If left untreated, the affected person may need to have the foot amputated or else they could die from sepsis. On August 4th, 2022, once the pain was too much, Daniel sought out help from medical professionals. The doctors gave him a diagnosis of trench foot. He was told to get a hotel room and to keep off his feet for at least a month, but Daniel being Daniel and also being homeless, this wasn't going to be a feasible solution. Blood would leak from his tattered feet from time to time, building up enough to leave small puddles, droplets, or even smears on the floor as he would walk, as evidenced by footage he recorded himself. In April of 2023, Daniel claimed that the trench foot problem was still persisting, having miraculously returned to his life out of nowhere. Of course, he blamed the trolls for this because they were allegedly manipulating his funds. I'm sure that is the likeliest of scenarios. Daniel has claimed that because he wore the same moldy socks for months on end, his feet are black, smelly, and bleeding. If he didn't spend the money he received from donations on stupid crap like overpriced mac and cheese.
Yeah, that is true. Because he doesn't bathe, his feet would be all black and shit. He'd have the hobbit's foot.
He'd be able to afford it.
That's what we called one of my friends. He at his house, he had hardwood floors. And he'd always walk around barefoot. You know how hardwood floors are. Even when they're fucking clean, they're still dirty. And you know, he'd get black shit all over his feet. And we called it hobbit's foot because he had weird feet, hairy feet too.
Few pairs of socks. Hell, he's been seen at Walmart before, so he could have picked up a value pack of socks for far less than $20, but that would just make too much sense. His feet appear to be breaking down, as he shared images of what appears to be a possible fungal infection and a wound on his foot. If you're squeamish, I'd recommend looking away. Ooh, I don't think walking around with those stompers would feel very pleasant. Moving along, it should be abundantly clear as soon as you cast your eyes upon him, but Daniel has some dental problems. He lacks most of his teeth due to him suffering from hypodontia. Hypodontia is a condition where an afflicted individual is missing 1 to 6 teeth, excluding the third set of molars. According to Luke, one of Daniel's former managers, Daniel had all of his baby teeth, but most of them were never replaced by a second set, leaving him with a mangled maw. Luke did mention that Daniel only drinks soda and rarely brushes his teeth, if ever, but it's safe to assume that dental hygiene is the last self-grooming category he maintains. Daniel's missing teeth have affected his ability to eat, which might explain why he often goes for softer foods like macaroni and cheese, but then again, he's also been known to enjoy slices of pizza and bags of chips, so maybe he's just a trooper. I'd imagine harder food hurts his gums and the few teeth he's got, as they're likely to be riddled with cavities. His teeth have visibly yellowed, and I'm sure they've got to be at least somewhat sensitive. Soda is incredibly corrosive and can do some pretty harsh things to your teeth if you don't have any self-control and just guzzle it down.
He says he chipped his teeth. That's just one thing he said on his community tab the other day.
The acids in soda, plus the sugar combining with the already present bacteria in his mouth, wreaks havoc as he sips his third sody pop of the day. And it would appear that he doesn't understand how a toothbrush works, as at one point he jammed one up his poo chute and then proceeded to brush his pearly whites with it. How else was he going to demonstrate his love for some underage girl on the internet? Or what he assumed they were, anyway? If Daniel doesn't take time to clean his chompers, he's going to lose the few he still got left. He'll go from looking like a jack-o'-lantern to just having gums for a smile. I doubt children are going to find that very alluring. Not that they were drawn to him much anyway, despite his peculiar interests. It's also worth mentioning that during one of his autistic fits, he may end up knocking out his two front snaggle teeth when he hits himself right in his mouth. And he doesn't just hit himself once or twice. He goes in 5, 6, 15 times. He's actually got quite the tolerance for self-inflicted pain. I've had enough of talking about his nasty teeth, so let's move along, shall we? More often than not, Daniel appears to be quite sickly. There's plenty of videos of him with snot hanging out of his natural canopy that he refers to as his nose, almost making contact with the phone's camera. It could be that he has a weaker immune system due to him not having a consistent fulfilling sleep schedule, alongside the colder temperatures in his area making his nose run. Either way, it's a disgusting sight regardless of how you cut it.
Nah, it's his diet that makes him able to get sick all the time and shit like that. He doesn't eat vegetables. All he eats is pasta and shit like that, and pizza, you know. You got to eat some broccoli, you know, some peas, some spinach. Spinach has got a lot of calcium in it, you know. You got to eat good. You got to eat nutritional food, man, or else you get sick and shit real quick.
His nose is actually a major indicator of how he's currently doing. If there's snot hanging out of it, bouncing around near his lips, he's sick. If it's covered in pus or peeled skin, he's been out in the sun for way too long. If it's bleeding, he either threw another one of his legendary temper tantrums or somebody put him in his place. It's safe to assume that if it is the latter, he probably had it coming. Historically, that has always been the case. When Daniel's nose had a large scab on it after getting smacked around by a disgruntled bodega employee, Daniel continued to draw attention to his injuries. He'd often pick at the wound, just what his viewers wanted to see. There are plenty of videos where you can see that the scab had been freshly picked, the red fluid glistening in the sunlight. Weirdly enough, the scab on his nose was remarked by trolls as strange, because the shape of it vaguely resembled the continent of Africa. At one point, Daniel was being bullied and he told his haters to go to Scab Africa.
So, if you guys have a problem with my scab, and you guys don't believe that I got attacked, and I fell on the pavement and scraped it, you guys could go back to Scab Africa.
I shouldn't have to explain this, but I'm sure one of you mouth breathers needs to hear it. Picking at scabs can slow down the healing process and lead to scars. He's very fortunate that his nose didn't turn out looking much worse than it already did to begin with. As of late, Daniel claims that he's pre-diabetic and that he may have heart issues and skin cancer. As with everything he says, we should take this with a grain of salt. However, the possibility of skin cancer is somewhat probable, given that he's outside more often than he's not, especially during the summertime. His skin has visibly weathered and aged at a much more drastic pace than somebody who has a home. As such, given that he looks like the sun has almost cooked him to a crisp, I'm willing to bet that if he doesn't currently have skin cancer, he most likely will get it in the future, if he happens to live long enough to see it anyway. Heart issues are another possibility, but there's no definitive way of telling. It could be that he has some...
Speaking of Skittles, man, I got I ordered the 5-pound bag off Amazon. I mean, the 3-pound bag, because it's only like $8. So I got Skittles for days. I probably got enough Skittles to last me for a month.
Kind of genetic predisposition, like it could run in his family, but it could also be his diet, as he tends to survive solely on junk food and sugary drinks, with the occasional meal from whatever restaurant he's swindling this week. Diabetes does seem like a possibility as well, given his aforementioned diet. It's hard to really discern if he's telling the truth or not, let alone if he's even aware of what actually is going on. For all we know, he could have been told one thing by the doctor and some trolls told him something else, leading to a conflicting story. Or just one that's predicated on a bunch of nonsense spewed by his latest fake race. We've also caught him in plenty of lies before, so it's really hard to take anything he says at face value. All in all, Daniel is not a healthy person by any means. He does not bathe, nor does he care about himself enough to even acknowledge the filth that has built up on his skin and teeth. But then again, his own mental health doesn't seem to bother him either, so perhaps expecting him to take care of his own well-being in some capacity is an expectation too high for someone like him. He's not going to get any better, regardless if he finds some new temporary housing or something else. His story is ultimately going to end with him being absolutely filthy, though the end is still up for debate. My guess is he'll either finally succumb to weather conditions or his fluctuating health will bring forth his demise. That is, if he doesn't get locked up for his bullshit in the meantime. Either way, we can rest easy knowing that an evil degenerate like him is always going to face some sort of repercussion. His plot armor can be mind-boggling at times, but it doesn't always exempt him from karmic punishment. Hey, if you
that's the thing about food on Amazon. Sometimes you can find good deals on there, and other times the food is so ridiculously expensive you don't even see how people buy it.
Arrested and put into the system, he might be forced to.
The Amazon chocolate chunk cookies are fucking fire, dude. They're better than Chips Ahoy and shit. They're the best, you know, chocolate chip cookie ever. They're even better than Famous Amos.
Bathe regularly, so he'll eventually have that going for him. But I got a sneaking suspicion that there aren't going to be any children giving them the light of day. And with that being said, that's going to be it for today's video. If you like what I do, leave a comment, rate, and subscribe. If you want to support me in a more personal way, you can check out the Patreon link and the Teespring link in the description. I've got more content coming down the pipeline.
What made her this way? What is the attraction?
Yeah, last night, Chris was becoming a goddess and all that shit. So a lot of the really crazy shit's coming up. So this one's probably going to be a really good one, actually. We got through the slump in the middle whenever Chris was just becoming transgender. You know, it power on the when he goes crazy.
What keeps us fascinated? This is the story of Chris Chan.
Yeah, you got to get your carbs, though, because the brain runs on carbs. If you go too keto, you get too much protein, but no carbohydrates. Your body starts burning fat and sugar, and you lose weight because you're dying. You know, your brain's not supposed to burn fat and sugar.
On November 15th, 2017, Christine went to Twitter to post about a new customization feature she unlocked in the Sonic the Hedgehog game, Sonic Forces, which allowed users to create characters with different colored eyes, wondering if the feature was inspired by Chris's own slight heterochromia. The next day, she bought the video game Mother Russia Bleeds, set in an alternate timeline.
Oh, okay, I thought you were talking about keto. Yeah, my aunt and uncle did keto and fucking, they had all these weird fake science pamphlets and shit like that. You know, I'm a pretty smart guy, so I can spot fake science pretty easily. And I don't know, man. Rich people aren't that smart. Like, they're eating all this organic meat. Man, they're a fucking dog. They give him T-bones and shit like that. He eats 100% organic T-bone steaks that are and shit like that every day. He eats better than anyone you know, my aunt and uncle's dog.
of 1980s Soviet Russia. On the 19th, Chris publicly updated the area code for Quickville, Virginia, as 69488, likely instructed to do so by Joshua Wise, the person responsible for altering much of Quickville's storyline and Chris's own personal beliefs. Members of the QB Farms discovered that it was a zip code in Germany, though could have been a coincidence, since the number was more likely a combination of references, the sex position, known as 69, and the white nationalist code, 1488, representing the 14-word slogan, "We must secure the existence of our people and a future for white children," and the Nazi salute, Heil Hitler, with the two eights referring to the eighth letter of the English alphabet, H. On the
I've seen there's a meme on the internet, and there's a place called 1488 Dentistry, and one of their posts on there that was making fun of it was like, it secured a future for my white teeth and shit like that. It was funny as hell. Yeah, I could check out. I'll see what Daniel's doing while we watch this too. I'll pop in there real quick.
November 20th, Chris uploaded a new drawing on Patreon featuring Christine and Sailor Mercury and Luna from the Japanese anime series Sailor Moon, having a conversation with supposed Japanese translations next to their English.
It's fucked up. They are also demanding that I have a job. So, like, for me to be able... So, probation wants me to have a job. Bob wants me to have a job. So, Bob wants me to have a job. Probation wants me to have a job. Everyone wants me to have a job. Okay.
Because you're not a singer-songwriter, you're a lunatic.
To go along with that, I have repeatedly put out applications for jobs, and all the jobs are asking that I, if I'm going to get hired, I have to have a rat payee, or I have to have reliable transportation. And since I don't have either or, they won't hire me.
Bullshit, Daniel. Denver's got good ass buses and shit like that, man. You'd be able to, no one would, if you say I ride the bus, you know, they wouldn't care. You know, it's a big city.
I've tried to put out applications for housing, and it's the same bullshit. They want a third party on my paperwork, and with my history, they don't want to move forward. They need to learn that it's like 5 years in the past, and I'm a completely different person now, and people don't give a shit. And to go along with that, I have to have I have to show my bank statements, and I have to have at least, which is kind of fucked up, I have to have at least $10,000 to rent. I have to have this month's payment, last month's payment, and that's minimum. Like, that is the bare minimum that even low-income housing will do.
Well, Fruity was talking about yesterday, he could do the, like sewer jobs and shit.
So I have enough money for not just first and last month's rent, food, and emergency. Otherwise, these housing services will not approve, which basically means I should have like realistically like $50,000 in my bank in today's market. So, Bob is, like I said, ignoring me, and I can't move forward with anything. And everyone is just in the fucking group chat just harassing me at this point because this is all fucked. So, good job, motherfucker Bob. You fucked up enough that you pretty much destroyed my life. I don't know why he would give me $4,000 on average a month and just not even pay for housing. And he gives me like $100 to $200 a week. Or I mean $100 to $200 a day, and then tells me to get a hotel room, tells me what to spend it on. And then Bob has also told me I might as well sue him. But I'm not going to sue a family member. That's fucking ridiculous. And then he just decides to cut ties and say that all I care about is his money. That ain't true at all. And if he believes that, he could go fuck himself. I don't care about his money. I care about just a fucking place to live. And if he thinks otherwise, he's a fucking moron. It's also now to a point that the feds are even, like, investigating
them. I made an Etsy one, and I put some Cyrax shit on there one time, and I sold one sticker. It was a return cutie sticker.
Guy is threatening me over my homelessness. So they could go fuck their lives. And yes, I just said that. And then they also want to say that, oh, you need security. Get security. You need housing. Go get housing. Well, you know what? Stop threatening to press charges on me if I don't, because that's just making my family more angry. And at this point, I don't care. Go ahead and press federal charges. My fans will send death threats to the FBI till the day they die.
No, they won't. Everyone hates you, Daniel.
And no, I did not send a death threat. Because I said that my fans will. And I'm not responsible for my fans. If my fans want to send death threats to the FBI, that's on them, not me. Because I'm not in charge of what my fans do. And And to go along with that, if the FBI really thinks I'm a threat, they need to really know what's really going on. And the stuff I keep talking about with my fans trying to assault me in public. And then they don't give...
Man, these dumbasses pretending to be probation officers and cops and FBI agents and all that shit to Daniel, better be careful. That shit's 5 years in prison. They don't play around about that shit.
I'm about to call the World Protection Agency, and I'm about to call the false incriminated or whatever, and see if I could get free money at this point, whatever the fuck they call that place, for false, for people that have been imprisoned under false charges. I'm gonna see if I can get free money now.
Yeah, imagine getting caught being a fake FBI agent or police officer or probation officer and going to jail for 5 years because you thought you were having a laugh at Daniel Larson's expense. You know what I mean? That'd be a really stupid reason to go to prison for, wouldn't it?
To stop saying I'm broke, because I'm clearly not broke, because I would have died a long time ago. And then also, why is Jacob Vanderwall sending me texts of him having conversations with Bob? Even Jacob Vanderwall saying to Bob in text messages that I've seen with my own fucking eyes at this point, which proves Bob is lying. The text messages from Jacob Vanderwall to Bob have said, why are you betraying Daniel? That's not okay. And Bob is saying, I don't give a fuck about this fucker. What have I done to Bob? What the fuck have I done to Bob to get him to be angry? Just because he didn't believe that I was in contact with Jacob Vanderwall to begin with, and then says that Jacob Vanderwall's threatening him? None of this makes sense, and Bob is a liar. And Bob is trying to make me look crazy, I found out. Because I have text to prove.
Oh no, Daniel, you do a good enough job at that yourself. Bob don't need to help.
I have literal text, which I could show in court, that prove that Bob is in contact and that Bob has lied. So, at this point, I don't give a shit what Bob says, because I know that he's a liar, and I know he's trying to make money off of me. And Bob is also trying to silence me, which isn't cool.
Daniel has very punchable cheekbones, doesn't he?
With what's going on with Bob and how he's not, like, there's too much evidence that I have proving that, like, I should already have an apartment. Well, actually, I shouldn't even have an apartment. I could actually have a house with the money that he was giving me. And then he just leaves me hanging, which I do realize it's not Bob's job to give me the money. I realize that, but it makes no sense why he wouldn't just give me 1 month's rent. It makes no fucking sense. And then I get arrested on my cases that are already false just because, like, I can't hire a good enough fucking lawyer. So I'm sitting there pleading guilty to everything, which only hurts my reputation. And Bob is living in a goddamn mansion. Like,
man, Daniel's so stupid. He does the Daniel Larson incident, pulls fire alarms, and he acts like everyone's out to get him.
So that motherfucker can go, like, fuck himself. And I am also, like I said, in contact with Jacob Vanderwall, who keeps sending me texts of conversations that he's having with Bob. And I could say this one thing. Grace's entire family hates Bob. So all this is doing is creating more conflict and actually getting us nowhere. And then Bob is saying, I might as well sue him. Sue him for what? Because I don't have a good enough reason other than straight up harassment. So at this point, if he's going to harass me, I can harass him. But don't forget to click the like button and subscribe. I'll be back on here in a bit.
Okay, I don't want you filming me then.
I don't give a fuck. Well, I didn't ask you.
You're on our channel now.
Okay, well, you guys just... You see what I mean? Do you guys see what I mean, though?
No, we don't see what you mean.
I was told by the CEO of another company that I work for...
That you can stay inside of a different company that you don't work for. You are retarded.
Wow, that's rude.
Okay, I don't care. Freedom of speech.
That is true. But it is very, very rude for you to say that.
My boss is over there if you'd like to talk to him.
Well, I did talk to him.
Okay.
Like, I don't know if you guys think this is a funny joke. I'm in training. So, I was told by the CEO of both companies to go live on the media for proof. Okay? And they're friends with this location. They're under sponsorship. And to say thank you for everything that they're doing and the free mail because of the sponsorship. They've already verified that. Now you guys want to harass me. And we've already verified.
Well, the cops are coming. You can tell the cops I'm harassing you. Nobody's scared of jail, so. That's all I'm saying.
Well, I mean, you can trespass me all you want. I'm doing nothing wrong.
Okay, well, you'll be trespassing when the police come.
Then I will trespass you from all of...
Trespass me? I don't give a fuck.
Columbia Records.
Fuck Columbia Records. I don't care about Columbia Records.
And we will never come back to this location.
Good.
Speech bubbles. It is likely that Wise provided her with falsified Japanese text from which to copy through role-playing as his alias, John Yamada, for none of the Japanese text.
Yeah, the cook staff, that Mexican dude is cool as fuck talking shit to him, saying he doesn't care about Columbia Records and all that. That's exactly how they treated him in jail. That's why they said they weren't nice. He'd start talking about Grace Vanderbilt. Man, shut the fuck up. You don't know damn Grace Vanderwall. Get the fuck out of here. You know, they'd be doing that kind of shit to him.
Text matched the English dialogue. For example, Christine expressed pride in being able to write her name in Japanese, when in fact, she had written, "Watashi wa penisu omotte imasu."
I made a video on the old Chicago incident. In fact, it's one of my favorite videos that I made by far. You can check it out. He thinks that they're printing off his nudes in the back and all kinds of crazy shit. It's a really good one. It's like an hour and a half long. Whenever Daniel has a big freak out, which he hasn't had in a while, and it's like a long live and all that, I make long ass videos about it. You know what I mean? Because I don't like to cut anything out except for play. Like on the old Chicago, it's like 2 hours long, and an hour of it was fucking Daniel staring into his phone saying, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. You know, I cut that shit out.
which translates to, I have a penis. Furthermore, what Chris assumed was smart hearts, smart minds, well-educated support, actually translated to, you look like the kind of person who fucks a guy in the ass and doesn't have the courtesy to ejaculate inside him. Soon after, Chris's monthly Patreon earnings dropped from $647 to $491, with at least one individual commenting that the reason for their departure was her failure to ship a comic book to them. On November 26th, Chris went to Twitter to reveal that Quickville would soon be holding elections for the next mayor and post a poll of the candidates, asking her readers who they would choose. The list consisted of actor Brendan Fraser, chairman.
You know what's unique about Mao Zedong? I drew him in high school as my portrait, and they're like, well, why would you want to draw him? You know, because he's a communist leader. He killed millions. I was like, because no one else is drawing him. You know what I mean? So I figured it was a cool thing to draw because, you know, that's the kind of thing a lot of people are like, I'm going to draw something that no one else is going to draw. I did a pretty good damn job, too.
China, Mao Zedong, Chris's fictitious secretary and former mayor, Alison Amber, and dictator of Chile, Augusto Pinochet. She later added that Russian president, Vladimir Putin, who was purportedly the US president in Quickville's dimension, was also in the running. She afterwards posted a similar poll asking her fans to vote for the new chief of Quickville Police Department. Her list of candidates included
a dog. Yeah, I remember that. I remember that fucking post. That was funny. The Chinese guy. Yeah, that was a pretty funny one.
Serial killer Ed Gein, drug trafficker and authoritarian ruler of Panama, Manuel Noriega, and Chris's own troll-given alias, Ian Brandon Anderson. On November 28th, Christine posted on Patreon her calculations determining the age of her My Little Pony counterpart, Nightstar, to be 1,500 years old, accounting for the different lengths of years and days in the pony setting of Equestria. In early December, Joshua Wise began enacting a new campaign of trickery and thought-altering by telling Chris stories and presenting altered images purporting to show Nazi forces invading Quickville, Virginia, in the hopes of capturing all the heroes of the town. Wise's John Yamada...
Yep, they were stupid and they didn't understand science, and the birds that they killed would eat a little bit of grain, but they ate a lot of the bugs. I remember that. And then one year, they fucking... starved real bad because they melted all their iron because they wanted steel, but all the iron and shit that they brought, it just made useless pig steel that wasn't worth anything. So they starved for a couple of years to accomplish nothing. And then you know, communism Russia in the 30s, they had open water reactors where they would just take water from a lake, run it into the fucking reactor and run it right out, dumping all the radioactive shit into the lakes. And there's lakes in Russia so toxic from rushing to make the plutonium to fight the capitalists that there's lakes, if you stand next to unprotected for 5 minutes, you will die.
Told her that the Christian Weston Chandler of the Quickville dimension had been kidnapped by Nazis and sent to the past, where he acquired satanic powers and abolished women's rights to enact his love quest, while also helping Nazi Germany win World War II. Thusly explaining why the United States of that alternate dimension was under Nazi occupation. Christine made an angry drawing and monologue depicting herself kicking Quickville's Christian in the groin for what he had done to the world, thusly killing Christian. On December 5th, Chris began posting new pages of Sonichu issue 15, detailing the births and early lives of Sonichu and Rosechu. Due to the influence of Joshua Wise, Chris changed the canonic birthday of Sonichu from March 17th to April 20th, either to reference the widely known date of 420, a celebration of marijuana smoking, or German dictator Adolf Hitler's birthday. Some members of the Kiwi Farms noticed that for the new pages, she was closely referencing, if not directly copying or tracing, the fan comic Rose True's story, by Kiwi Farms user Tricky. However, Chris took extra effort to depict the tail of the Raichu Pokemon, which later turns into Rosechu, as a distinctly round-tipped female tail. Upon noticing this, Joshua Wise convinced her otherwise by claiming to be Rosechu who had allegedly borrowed his computer to message Chris. On December 6th, Christine confessed on Facebook that Rose True was born male. Okay, who's ready to have their minds totally, royally f***ed up? Rosie, our prime Rose True, sweetheart of Sonichu, was born as a Pichu, male! The d***ed trolls were correct. Up until around the 4-cent garbage adventure, Rosie did have, not a vagina, but a penis. She had the operation to become fully woman and give birth to Christine, Roberta, and Sarah. I felt super mortified and beyond shocked when she came out to me as a trans woman herself. Since when I created her after Sonichu...
Yeah, whenever I get a fact wrong, correct me and I'll remember it. You know what I mean? Because I can't... a lot of these guys, like Daniel, I've only been covering for about a year, you know, so I will get some shit wrong, you know, from time to time. We're going to watch the Kusari documentary after I finish the Chris.
Around 2000, I had created her to be a female-only Pokemon, like a Kangaskhan. But, apparently, even though I am creator, apparently I am not a total goddess over my own city and creations. So, I will now put this to everyone online for their responses. Do you like it that for once the trolls were right? Or would you rather I revert back to telling everyone in book 15 that our Miss Rosie Rosechew was always female? She wanted me to come forward with her truth on her behalf, as much as it really hurts me deep. I really feel like I should be reeled into my Pokeball and stored in the PC a while. I accept my rose.
Chris, this isn't 300 years from now. They can't give transgender people uteruses and shit. You know, but they probably will be able to in the future.
My rose, as having been born male. That is all. Feeling greatly conflicted by this latest revelation, Chris posted a poll on Twitter asking her fans whether they would like to acknowledge the truly transsexed Rose Chu or reject the so-called official history and continue considering Rose Chu as have always been a girl. She later added that one choice would hurt Christine, while the other would hurt Rose Chu, so the trolls would apparently be happy with either outcome. Chris's trollsome ex-girlfriend, Jessica Quinn, returned...
Really? I would figure if someone got a uterus transplanted, they would have to, at the very least, take those fucking immune system blockers that people with artificial... livers and kidneys, you know, and all, I mean, not artificial, fucking, you know, transplanted. They got to take some medicines to keep their immune system from destroying their organ.
On Facebook, to commend Christine for the progressiveness of establishing a male-to-female transgender Sonichu character. A day later, the voting on the poll concluded, with 57% of the people voting to recognize a transgender Rosechew. Upon seeing these posts, notable QB Farms poster and moderator, the American Hedgehog, created a thread on the forums to collect and discuss all the recent and forthcoming information dispelled by Chris, which was decidedly made under duress or under the influence of an unknown troll feeding her ideas, who was at the time only referred to as Idea Guy. By this point, Wise had messaged some people on the QB Farms using his account BallsyMaker94, boasting about his involvement, but he had told them to keep his identity a secret. Marvin, moderator on the QB Farms, and the original man in the picklute, allegedly knew BallsyMaker94 was the Idea Guy, and even provided him with some advice concerning some trolling schemes. On December 11th, Christine unveiled a new character currently present in Quickville, Battery Charge Heart, CPU of Quickville, inspired by the CPUs, or goddesses, of the Hyperdimension Neptunia anime. Though unlike the original CPUs, Battery Charge does not represent any specific video game console.
Yep, Marquita, and there are left-wing snowflakes and there are right-wing snowflakes. There are snowflakes on both of those sides, you know what I mean?
It was also on this day that Chris released a new YouTube video in which she recites what she believes to be a Cherokean chant, as informed by the Idea Guy, Joshua Wise, when in fact, it was the combination of the Russian taunt, Anu Chikibriki, popularized by the video game series Stalker, and Davai, which meant come on or let's go. She is also squatting with a bottle of vodka in front of her while wearing a cap and striped Adidas tracksuit, a wardrobe and mannerism associated with the Gopnik subculture of Russia and other former Soviet states.
Anu cheeky breeky. A new 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 cheeky breeky. Bye-bye. Bye-bye. A new cheeky breeky. A new cheeky breeky. A new cheeky breeky. Bye-bye. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.
I like the Fallout 4 engine a lot better than 3. And the New Vegas is still a better game than 4 because of the game itself. You know, I'm a kind of guy that I put, you know, story over graphics. You know what I mean?
On December 14th, Marvin used his Howard Winslow Twitter account to tell Chris that the video game convention, MAGFest, would hold a panel discussing Chris Chan.
I don't know. I think at this point it'd be safe to argue that Chris is crazier than Daniel, because Chris is starting to believe, you know, that Chris is a goddess and all this magical bullshit. You can grow a vagina from listening to music. You know, all that shit that Chris thought.
Marvin encouraged her to attend. Also on that day, Christine urgently went to Facebook to inform her readers that Sylvana Rosechew, who existed in the same dimension as her entire city of Quickville, was lost in time, destroyed in the past. She pleaded for her fans to believe in Sylvana in the hopes that their power could bring her back. Later again, Christine wrote on Twitter that she sought revenge for those who destroyed Sylvana's original form, but in return presented the character's new form who appeared in her stead, Neo Sylvana Rosechew. It was around this time that Wise convinced Chris that the hyperdimension Neptunia character Neptune was waiting for her at a GameStop.
Oh yeah, if you really want to get interested in Chris, watch the earlier ones of this if you haven't, because Chris has sex with his Xbox. He sends all kinds of creepy video messages about, oh, Ivy, I can't wait till we have our sexy time together, you know, and cringe, weird shit like that. That's funny, you know what I mean? Right now, this is starting to get funny again because Chris, you know, believes that Chris is a goddess now, you know. So pretty soon he tries to marry Sonichu and shit. I know a lot of the story from here on.
Chris drove to the GameStop from which she was banned for pepper spraying an employee, honked her car horn, and repeatedly screamed Neptune's name. Afterwards, she went up to the window of the game retailer and quote-unquote scanned the...
I don't think you need to cast any spells on those two. I think those two are just bad for each other to begin with.
The interior, but did not see Neptune, so Chris made her way back.
Supposedly, the really bad witches and shit are ones that have had familiars, you know, passed down through the generations and shit, like voodoo. Like a certain family might have a voodoo spirit and shit. You know, I don't know if I believe in any of that shit, but that's what they say.
Home. Also in mid-December, Joshua Wise, messaging Chris while pretending to be Magichan Sonichu in Quickville, told her that he prophesied Sonichu would give birth to Chris's long-longed-for daughter, Crystal, after being anally penetrated.
Oh yeah, that Greek one. You know the one.
By Christine. Wise, as Magichan, said that if Chris drew that sex act, then she would not have to do it in real life, and Crystal would still come into being. She then made a drawing showing herself having anal sex with Sonichu in order to produce Crystal. At around December 17th, Chris told one of Joshua Wise's online personas,
Hermaphroditos, look it up. There's a goddess. There was a, yeah.
That she was determined to go to her half-brother, Cole Smithy, in New York City to convince him to look after their mother, Barbara. Chris thought that a newly crafted Sonichu medallion made by Wise would be arriving in the mail, which would provide her with the powers to find out Cole's home address, though Wise never told her of any such thing. He convinced
Chris. That's the question, Steve. Arguably, Chris is not, because Chris just gradually started to hate men so much that the only other option was for him to become female. Whereas people who are really transgender know they're transgender when they're kids and shit like that. You know what I mean? I mean, it's really debatable. I try and say just Chris now instead of he or she, you know?
Chris, not to go to New York, for Smithy needed not get involved in the Chandler's affairs, and that her family was low on funds. The next day, Christine confessed to one of the characters portrayed by Joshua Wise that she had renounced Christianity and instead began worshipping the CPUs of Hyperdimension Neptunia. She reasoned that she could get more speedy and efficient advice and guidance from the CPUs as opposed to God and Jesus. Chris was further convinced of the power of the CPU goddesses because she had the ability to create her own CPU after learning from them and the opportunity to. Yeah. She reasoned that she could get more speedy and efficient advice and guidance from the CPUs as opposed to God and Jesus. Chris was further convinced of the power of the CPU goddesses because she had the ability to.
If you switch religions, you cannot believe in Jesus anymore. That's okay with me, says Chris. I'm only sharing my initial religion transitioning thoughts and insights.
Create her own CPU.
I'm going the whole 18 yards this time. You can quote me on that. I also take into consideration that I was able to create a new CPU goddess.
Learning from them. And the opportunity
to be fresh and new and learn from all the other CPUs as well. Not to mention that it is written in the prophecy and destiny that I will be parent of her own CPU candidate, which she too will ever make me so proud. Chris, you crazy than a motherfucker. And it's straight. Chris believes that Chris is Jesus now, right? Jesus, after saying, you know, definitely I'm going to quit Christianity and join the anime religion, you know?
To become part of the family team of CPUs was a dream that Jesus could never grant her, no matter how hard she prayed. On December 23rd, Christine posted two more drawings featuring the Sailor Moon characters, Sailor Neptune, Michiru, and Haruka, claiming that their speech bubbles had been translated into another language, when in fact, the accompanying translations were German lines of pro-Nazi dialogue taken from the video game series Brothers in Arms and Wolfenstein. 3 days later, she updated her Facebook followers with troubling news from Quickville, provided to her by Joshua Wise.
You know what sucks, Steve? There was one predator on Dads Against Predators that was the best one by far. It was this dude sitting in his car on his lunch break smoking a cigarette, and he tried to get a 14-year-old to come there to meet him. And he was talking about to the Dads Against Predators guys that, he's like, yeah, and I kept talking to her because I knew it was a scam. And when I got here, what was it? It was a scam. And then his manager and shit came out because it was past his break. And then they told the manager and shit what he'd done. And then they found out that he was already a registered sex offender. And then he got fired from there. And, you know, and then they arrested him the next day. Yeah, so that was my favorite one, but they don't have it anymore, man. I like it. He's like, it's a scam. I knew it was a scam. I don't know. I thought it was, and the way he talked, he had that New Yorker kind of way of talking, you know?
She thought that there was civil unrest in her town because in addition to rallies held by Ku Klux Klansmen, DJ Jamsta Sonichu was put on trial for molesting Punchy Sonichu, which resulted in the Punchy Sonichu riots. She denied rumors.
I pray sometimes, but not very often. It's a big universe. I don't think you want to bother God too much, you know? It's only if it's important, you know?
That Magichan was running Quickville like a police state, as he was not a criminal, and neither was the new mayor of Quickville, Brendan Fraser. Chris added that to stop the criminals wreaking havoc in her town, the Trollbusters Anti-Troll Task Force was being reorganized into the Quickstapo, a reference to the secret police of Nazi Germany. After a break of 10 days from online posting, Chris returned to Twitter on January 3rd, 2018. When she noticed that artist Brian Frogboy, also known as Brian Shickley, posted a page from his so-called Christian prequel comic, focused on the earlier years of Chris.
Oh, in one of my Cyrax videos, there was a video that I got on Facebook, and it said it had a guy on there, and a predator, they lured him there, and they're like, you ever done this before? No, I got a clean record. I've never been in trouble before. And then the guy slapped him in the face, and he's like, what are you doing now? Huh? What the fuck are you doing now? And I put that after Cyrax said, I've got a clean record. I put that on there in one of my videos. I can't remember which one, but I thought it was pretty damn hilarious.
Chris Chan's life. Brian stated that he did not intend on finishing the new project and left it aside as practice. Christine commented that she was very interested in seeing how the story developed and how the artist would treat some aspects of Christian's past life. With this encouragement, Brian continued to work on completing the comic before the end of the month. 2 days later, Chris liked a video on YouTube which claimed to feature subliminal frequencies that would cause one to astral project, or to theoretically have their consciousness travel to another time and place outside of the confines of their physical body. Also on that day, Chris announced a surprise marriage over Twitter and Facebook. I am celebrating the love between Magi-chan Sonichu and his mentor and lover, Mewtwo. They had got secretly married recently. I'm truly happy for both of them, and if Sylvana were there, the three of them would have made a lovely harem. On January 6th, Chris arrived for the first day of the music and gaming festival, MAGFest, and spent a great deal of time taking photos with her fans. She also attended a freelance art panel, where she interrupted the discussion to provide some advice from personal experience. It was noted that she brought a baseball bat with her to be used in a case of self-defense. The schedule for the second day of the convention featured a retrospective of the history of Sonichu and its creator, Chris Chan. Christine attended the panel as an observing audience member. The room was veritably packed, and the panelists discussed subjects of an intimate level, which included the many trolling sagas, and She Came for Quick, the drawing in which Chris depicted himself sexually satisfying his friend, Megan Schroeder. After the discussion was concluded, the panelists gave Chris a chance to speak, after which time, the audience gave Christine a standing ovation and encouraging applause. She proceeded to walk down the aisle, high-fiving and hugging her adulating fans. Chris's longtime trollsome gal pal, Kim Wilson, was also in attendance and later recounted the experience. The panel was created to definitely be a huge mockery of Chris. Chris wasn't invited, as far as I'm aware of, and only decided to come because he got wind of it. It was more or less of a surprise to the people running the panel when they found out he was there. They definitely glossed over a lot of their slides and made it seem more positive. A lot of the shit they said was wrong.
I know, right? Many a dumbass has fucking tried to intimidate me with the bat, and it always ends up wrapped around their throat in the end. It's really easy to take a bat from somebody. A bat's too long. It's weighted wrong. Like, if you had like a 2x2 or something like that, that's what you'd want.
Even simple stuff like, he got fired from Burger King. Apparently, their biggest source wasn't even the Wikipedia, but ran.
I don't have a gun, but I've got all kinds of golf clubs and baseball bats and axe handles and shit. Remember that Clint Eastwood movie where he went in there and did with the axe handle and just beat the shit out of like eight guys?
Some videos of other people talking about him or interviews, which is just lazy, but pretty funny. So after Chris spoke and was heading back to his seat in the back, he was high-fiving people. This one girl got a high five and a hug from him and basically just shrieked with happiness. She shook her hand at her friend, yelling about how Chris touched her hand and wouldn't let anything touch that hand, and kept going on.
Shit, if I was president, the Sahara Desert's 40 miles from the ocean and it's below sea level, so if you flooded it, it'd give Africa a giant sea and shit. If I was president, I'd make everybody do that, because then it'd moderate the weather in Europe and Asia and make it warmer and make it rain more. It'd all around, and then they'd have a sea, you know, full of fish in Africa. It'll rain more in Africa. It'd just be a really good thing to do, you know?
On and on about how Chris touched her hand and was overjoyed by it, to the point that I actually thought this girl was going to go find him to suck his dick. She wasn't even a fat or unattractive girl either, so IDK. Marvin was also there and later wrote his account of the event on Kiwi Farms. What everyone seems to be wondering, does Chris smell? No, at least there isn't like some miasma cloud hanging around him. I was pretty close to him, but I obviously didn't stick my nose in his shirt or anything.
Oh, that's funny, Steve. Now you don't run for president because a lot of times, they'll kill you. You know, you're not in the club. You don't even try politics. It's not for you, you know.
So if he's got a smell, you definitely won't notice anything just casually hanging around him. And even if you really are determined to get a whiff, it's probably not that strong. It helps that it's the winter, and so he's not hustling around in the heat. No perfume or axe this time either. Chris stayed back after the panel to talk with her fans and take photos with them.
If Chris Chan wanted to run for president, would you vote for Chris Chan? I would.
What are your thoughts on it?
If it was Chris Chan versus Biden, I'd probably vote for Chris Chan.
I love all gays and lesbians!
Ow, ow! Also in the audience was Adam Stackhouse, the winner of the 2007 Parappa the Rapper Song Contest, who was the subject of much of Chris's anger at the time. They seemed to finally meet on pleasant terms and took a selfie.
Man, I wish there are two negative side effects that this weed that I've got gives really bad. My eyes are so red, I can feel that they're red, and I wish I had some eye drops, and my mouth is very dry unless I drink something like every few seconds.
Be together. On January 9th, Brian Frogboy posted another image from his Sonichu prequel comic. Chris commented that the page accurately described his yearnings back then, having devoted too much time on fulfilling his love quest instead of focusing on Sonichu, admitting to being too selfish back then. The next day, Alan Denton, a writer for the Sonic Boom TV series, tweeted, "I love when people are inspired enough by something to write their own fanfiction. Totally support that. But, and I can't believe I have to say this, if you then insist to the creators that your made-up story become canon, you've gone too far. Whisper silently to my folder of Sonichu fanfic, but not you. You'll all be canon one day." 2 days later, Christine shared newly uncovered memorabilia concerning her late father, Bob Chandler, which included a newspaper clipping regarding his 25th anniversary of working with General Electric, and flyer advertising his so-called musical pushcart, which would play vintage music for any willing listeners in downtown Charlottesville. On January 10th, the idea guy, Joshua Wise, invited an unknown user of the Kiwi Farms to take part in a trollsome conversation with Chris, using the messaging function of the digital video game distribution service, Steam. The other party...
Yeah, you'll have to post a link to that because my search results aren't showing up. I put in Daniel Larson, cancer, grandma, autism, and then nothing came up.
...was told to portray the part of high-ranking SS figure during World War II, Hermann Fegelein, who was allegedly threatening to lead German forces into the My Little Pony land of Equestria, claiming that it had belonged to the Reich centuries ago. Their conversation ultimately concludes inconclusively, with the threat of invasion pending. Wise later wrote that he pushed the Nazi storyline onto Chris, since she easily identified them as a villainous entity and did not understand why Russians, North Koreans, or communists were bad. On January 16th, Wise convinced Chris that Nazis had planted a surveillance bug inside her Christine doll, which she had fashioned out of a My Little Pony figurine to make it look more like herself. She proceeded to destroy the doll on camera.
Freaking Nazis. I am not afraid of any of you. And you do anything else in Quickville, I'm going to send you all down the river. You may as well send yourselves down.
Also, Chris figured out that that fine old solution they were talking about in the episode yesterday was Nazis. Yeah, he's a bright one, isn't he?
River. Before I send you all down the river. You think I can be bought off like just by having...
The whole world is in decline because we're not using nuclear power. We can barely suck enough oil out of the ground fast enough to give 10% of people a life worth living. You know what I mean? So, you know what I mean?
Even the ones I end up putting together, you end up bugging. Well, I won't have it, and you all will not be in Quickville for much longer. See to it personally. Oh, I really glued this thing good. Anyway.
She then uses a part of a bed frame to attempt to crush the doll further.
So there!
3 days later.
Chris is sweating from that. What a pussy.
Chris continued the anti-Nazi theme by uploading a video on YouTube in which she destroys her Christmas tree to intimidate the Nazis, which were apparently invading the My Little Pony land of Equestria.
You friggin' Nazis! I'm gonna kick you all out of Equestria!
Yeah, but nuclear, it costs a tenth of what it costs to make electricity with coal. So you could, they could sell it for half price and still make more money than they do now for like 5 cents a kilowatt hour. And if it was 5 cents a kilowatt hour, everyone would, you know, have like a tomato plant growing in every corner or a pepper plant, you know, over here and all that kind of shit. Everyone would like to grow their own food because the sad fact of the matter is you can't get a good bell pepper at the store. It's the fucking truth. What Chris is doing right now should be enough to put your ass in the nut house. If this video is posted online, you should be put in there for at least 2 weeks.
What do you think of that now, you freaking Nazis? Heed my warning! You get out of Equestria, you freaking Nazis!
Chris then rips up a picture of wrestler Hulk.
There is a kind of cold fusion that works. It's some kind of muon shit, but it makes a lot of energy to make the particles and shit like that. Right now, what we've got, the best thing is nuclear power. Because, all right, here's how it works. And the Mark IV ones, that they burn the uranium and plutonium instead of making yellow cake for nukes, is why we use the old ones, because there's lots of byproducts. The new ones burn the plutonium and as fuel along with the uranium, and it burns the fuel until a family of four's electric consumption for 20 years is the size of a cigarette lighter. That much waste. So, yeah, it's a good option.
Kogan, in reference to notable Kiwi Farms commenter Hollywood Hulk Hogan, who regularly made fun of Chris's weight.
Who's a fat ass now, Hulkster? My favorite wrestler is Chris Benoit. My brothers, sisters, and I of Antifa, we will assure you freaking Nazis, get the hell out of Equestria now.
Mommy, did you pack my lunch? Yes, I'm taking you to the protest.
I'll be back. Hasta!
On January 20th, in response to an artist on Twitter posting an image of their new waifu, or illustrated, usually female character one may feel romantically attached to, Chris objected to the concept, writing that she never understood how people could feel that a character from a show who has dimensions out of
shit. In the 70s, they made carburetors that evaporate fuel better than into vapor better than fuel injectors, and it would give everybody like 30% more fuel economy than even the fuel injected ones. But you know, the oil companies totally bought that patent because they don't want that getting out. You know what I mean?
Their league.
And you know, now we're gonna go away from oil anyway, so they're really stupid for not doing that.
Was like a significant other to them. She was instead more old-fashioned, preferring real women. Christine added that she only purchased a dakimakura or body.
Never put Brown's gas in a regular car motor because the Brown's gas, since it's not liquid, it's drier and it's bad for your piston rings.
A pillow with a female anime character's image on it, out of peer pressure, suggested to do so by one of her ex-girlfriends. During the time Chris had it, she never envisioned it as anything more than just a pillow, and apparently had already disposed of it. The next day, Chris tweeted a retraction. Hey everyone, I'm tweeting right now to retract and correct the comment I made a short while ago about waifus. I was insensitive, not only to all of you in this world, but also to those individuals who are fictional here, who all are real in the other dimension of this world. Those waifus are real. They all
you never know. Chris actually see Sonichu and Rosichu, because those crazy people, they have what's called a tulpa, and that's when you basically create a fictional character in your mind, give it a personality, and then you'll even start to see it, which is some really sick, weird shit, you know?
Have feelings, too. I was in mind of a year or two ago when I was proposed the question about my waifu by my past girlfriend. I did not really have a waifu then because I had never really thought about it beforehand, ever. Soon after, she deleted these tweets and in their place retweeted the original tweet which sparked this discussion and wrote that all those who had waifus should treat them with the utmost kindness and respect as they were real, had families, and all that. The sudden change of mind may have been the result of Joshua Wise beginning to roleplay with Christine as the hyperdimension Neptunia character, Blon. They got into arguments concerning Chris's laziness and how she would treat Blon if they were in a relationship. When asked what she would do if on a date with Blon, Chris wrote, "Firstly, we get to the bedroom. Communication is key, and I would listen. We get undressed. I would make out with you, make my way downwards, and I would put my two middle fingers onto your clit for starters. Then, I would progress into your vulva with my fingers and rub the front inside of your vagina. And with your request, I would lick it on the clit, the edges, and even put my tongue into your vag." This allegedly disgusted Blon. On January 22nd, QB Farms moderator
Chris is, was, and always will be a creep.
Creators revealed the identity of the idea guy as Joshua Wise. They also posted his date of birth, home address.
I know, he's like, "I'm high functioning, time to go play with some Legos."
And the Facebook pages of himself and his family members. The forum members claimed that the reason for the revelation was because the content that Chris was producing under Wise's influence was quote-unquote trash. Others then came forward with information that Wise had provided them, including
I hate the way Queen Cobra talks about sucking dicks and all that and getting fucked and all that shit like that on stream. So that's a real classy lady there, tell you what.
New pages of the Sonichu comic that were drawn under his influence. For example, some of Christine's characters became Islamic extremists or drug dealers. Also, Chris created new Sonichu characters, including Bundy Chu, in honor of infamous serial killer Ted Bundy, and Robert Chu, in honor of her father. Thinking that publicizing his personal information would be enough to deter him.
What I find sad is he's had four kids. So four kids had to grow up in fucking fear their crazy ass mom who goes crazy and throws fits and starts screaming for no reason all the time. I feel bad for them kids. You know their childhood is fucking hell.
Contacting Chris again, QB Farms members assumed that the Idea Guy saga was over. However, Joshua Wise, playing the part of John Yamada, instead informed Christine that he had come under attack and could not communicate efficiently with her anymore. So he redirected Chris to Johnson Wiles, Yamada's original character, or OC, residing in a different dimension, through whom Wise continued to message Chris. On the 23rd, Chris officially created a new pony character, influenced by Wise, named Cunty Nugget, apparently of Vietnamese heritage, whose name Wise claimed translated to happiness. 5 days later, Chris attended a Pokemon trading card game tournament at the End Games card game store, wherein participants...
Well, yeah, of course he has four kids. Don't you know it's Idiocracy? The really smart people end up not having any kids, and the dumb motherfuckers that are deficient like her have as many as she can. No offense to the kids, you know, they might be fine people, you know.
And then played with newly released cards contained within a pre-release kit with an entry fee of $30. On the final day of January, Chris posted a YouTube video in which she asks for people to buy her old Pokemon cards to help pay for her mother's dental care.
Hello, everybody. This is Christine Chandler coming to you live from home once again.
No idea, but one of the videos I watched on Cobra was talking about how she has four kids.
And Captain's Log, Stardate 0131201.
I would doubt that they talked to her like ever.
18. Yes.
You heard her. She had the shower running. She is sitting next to it, and her parents are telling her to turn off the damn water. and she's sitting there screaming, I'm washing my face. Those poor kids probably don't talk to her. That would be my, you know, and that's someone she doesn't have a position of power over. So for the kids, it was even worse.
And before we begin with this, I would like to give a special shout out and appreciation to Brian Frogboy on Twitter for the Chris Chan prologue comic book. Hey, we're going to try, I'm working with him. We're going to try to get a few copies of that book going around. I'm personally doing that. I'm giving, it's the okay. Though the story, all the details are a bit off here and there. It's still very good. Anyway, this video, aside from that, is about, in particular, my collection of old Pokemon cards. I am literally going to be selling these on eBay, and I'm pretty much showing you all what you get here. Anyway, so I'm just going to thumb through this, and you'll get to see what you get. Get more than 150 or so cards. You're not going to find these elsewhere, and you're going to get plenty of bang for your buck, not only because of the cards, but because of the bonus content that is mine and mine alone.
Chris goes on to display two binders filled with Pokemon cards.
That's my very first Pokemon card, base set Charmeleon. And do you know where I got this card from? I literally got it from just Nintendo Power Magazine. I'm thinking about adding this to a listing as
You had to have Nintendo Power back in the day, man. There was no internet. You'd just buy a game and wouldn't be able to beat it until you got a Nintendo Power about it.
As well for its own listing, and I'd sign it. Here, watch me sign it right now, all right? Now, this guy's going to need a dental job. This listing is definitely going to help restore my mother's teeth. She still has lots of problems with that. This is it. This is my very first card ever. And I definitely personally document it. The card that's in here. See? I got my very first Pokemon card from the February 1999 Nintendo Power issue. Yay! Number one card. Alright, so that's it for now. In a little while, I'll probably do a dance video because that was a pay request. But I have so many other things, obligations to take care of right now, believe it or not. It's true. Alright, so y'all have a great, safe day. Keep a happy thought.
The binders were listed on eBay with buy it now prices of $700 and $200 respectively, and the signed Nintendo Power magazine was put up for $150. Card trader Kabbalah Coffers offered $500 for the larger binder, which Chris eventually accepted. Upon receiving the package, Kabbalah Coffers filmed an unboxing video showcasing what he received.
As you can see, she wrote handle with care everywhere, and this is loose, but rolling around in the box.
He proceeds to sanitize the binder and was optimistic about his purchase. He later appraised the cards and reckoned that he comfortably made his money back after the first 14 pages, and believed that in a few years, the contents of the binder could be worth $3,000 or $4,000. In response to the purchase, Chris notified her Facebook followers that all of the proceeds went to her mother, Barbara, who promptly scheduled a dental appointment. Her Facebook friend, William Elliott Waterman, doubted that she could set up an appointment so quickly. And Chris's trollsome ex-girlfriend, Jessica Quinn, was optimistic.
Yeah, I had to send a retarded family money today.
That Chris would, for the time being, stop using her mother to sell her junk. Not long after, Chris purchased two Pokemon cards on eBay, costing a total of $52. On February 1st, Christine bought the PlayStation 1 game Blast Chamber on eBay for $5. Also on that day, Chris posted a photo on Facebook of herself drawing new comic pages on a clipboard clipped onto an easel, proud to be standing and drawing. 2 days later, in response to a comment on Twitter, Brian Frogboy wrote that he personally did not believe cartoons were real in another reality, but did not influence what Chris believed. Chris replied, stating, "That is a real shame that you say that, at Brian Frogboy, because our fictional individuals are real, and they do exist. They are alive and breathing and living, just like you. I, and everyone else in this world. You should open your mind and heart to them fully. After another fan reply, Brian wrote that if Christine truly believed a cartoon reality existed, then she should consult a professional. Chris responded, "Consult a professional" is another insensitive comment. That is strike two at Brian Frogboy. More appropriately, you should see it for yourself to try to understand for yourself. The next day, Brian Frogboy posted a printable illustration of his rendition of a Sonichu medallion, which Chris did not approve.
I'm a little country pop. We're gonna make your hazer stop. I tell you straight up, no lies. Our emotions, thoughts, and love.
On February 5th, after coming in contact with Chris, the independent, self-confessed boy band Boy Spicy released a song titled Love is Love, featuring Christine on lead vocals. She sings the lyrics she originally wrote for Sonichu Issue 12, with Boy Spicy providing the instrumental backing track. On February 7th, Brian Shickley revealed that he had received a printed proof copy of his Christian prequel comic, which was printed by the custom book publishing site Lulu. They discussed how he would provide the books for Chris to sell by herself, stating that she would be getting all the profits. 2 days later, Chris announced that her Sonichu comic books were once again available for purchase from Lulu for the first time since her ban in December 2015, which she evaded by creating a new account.
Christian. Arguably the most documented person in history.
On February 11th, YouTube user Geno Samuel 2 uploaded a video titled Christian, A Comprehensive History, Part 1, a multi-part documentary project presenting a near-complete chronology of Chris's life based on all available information in an objective manner. The video was quickly shared on QE Farms, and the channel steadily grew in popularity. He would continue to regularly upload installments of the Comprehensive History series over the next 5 months.
This is the story of Christian.
On February 16th, Christine received her copy of the Christian prequel comic by Brian Shickley and posted a photo of herself holding it up. On the 20th, she posted photos of her new Christine and Nightstar dolls, which were repainted My Little Pony figurines like their predecessors. 2 days later, she spilled paint on several pages of Sonichu Issue 14, but instead of throwing them away, decided to list the stained pages on eBay, announcing so in a YouTube video.
From a recent painting project, I had an accident. I spilled some paint on my hand-drawn cover of Sonichu number 14, as well as the first three pages. So I'm going to be tracing and redrawing these four items. So at this point, I'm going to be putting these up on eBay. So if any of y'all would like something that was originally hand-drawn with me from amongst my books, now's a good time. Even though it's a bit damaged, but still, you know how it is with artists. That's what makes it more unique. And I'll personally put a certificate of authenticity on all these, and these will come in a pay sleeve. So step right up and pay some good money for a little bit more of something authentic from me. Thank you and have an awesome day.
That's funny. Gino's like, YouTube historian Geno Samuel started his document.
The pages were listed with an asking price of $100.
Yeah, originally Chris's dumbass was taking cream that women rub on their breasts to get rid of hot flashes. It wasn't for HRT or anything like that. And, you know, Chris is fucking retarded. So Chris being Chris, well, you know the story. Well, now you know the story.
And were sold 2 minutes after being posted. On February 24th.
Now Chris is on the regular hormones.
Celebrated her 36th birthday and made a special announcement on Facebook. Everyone, please listen. I would like to personally talk about Christian Love Day, as it is not only my own birthday. It is not a day of loving Christians, though they are people who deserves as much kindness and love as everyone else respectively and individually does. And side note, it is also Mexico's Flag Day. But what Christian Love Day truly means to me, and I feel should be encouraged for everyone else to follow in suit on every February 24. If you would, please. It is a day to extend your love and kindness to everyone, period, and do it with as much gusto and sincerity as you like. May they be family, sweetheart, friend, ally, workmate, creature, plant, an individual who is a fantasy character.
Buttworm, and you got Cyrax as your picture. That's funny. I like it when he shits himself on camera, and you can hear it. One time I had it on stream, and I kept going back to the noise over and over and over again.
This world of ours, and, of course, a stranger or someone you do not know yet. Share the love. Moreover, let your friendship and family circles grow. Do not be shy. The more genuine love and kindness you give, the more you do get from them and everyone else. Give a hug. Give a smile. Say hey there. For Christian Love Day is the special day we give love and kindness to everyone. Thank you all so much. Love, Miss Christine Weston Chandler. For the time being, it seemed that Christine had regained some semblance of control of her own life and her mind. Her online reputation continued.
You know, Chris is kind of a first world problem in of Chris's self. You know what I mean? Chris is a first world problem. Everything about him is, he's our problem.
It's to provide her with additional income in the form of eBay sales and Patreon supporters. However, out of sight of the public eye, individuals with menacing plans were toying with her emotions and beliefs, and were about to push her to her breaking point.
Watch one episode of that horrible hyperdimension Neptunia shit if you really want. I watched an entire episode of it, the first episode, and I couldn't do it.
What made her this way?
It was really, really weird. Like, I can't see how anybody would get into it. Kind of weird, you know?
What is the attraction? What keeps us fascinated? This is the story of Chris Chan. By late February 2018, the idea guy, Joshua Wise, was firmly molding Christine's thoughts and creative ideas. Unbeknownst to members of the QB Farms or other outsiders, Wise was by this point accompanied by three other people, one of whom was Stephen Boyd, who also role-played as fictitious characters with Chris, including one Gwen Mikoto, who allegedly lived in Kentucky, passing off his own family's address as Gwen's. The two other parties were involved to a lesser extent, and the identities of whom were never.
Don't you hate it when the weed hits back? You know, if you hit it and it hits back and it hurts.
Were revealed nor fully uncovered. The idea guys primarily communicated with Chris through a closed communal chatting space on the instant messaging platform Discord. Here, they frequently convinced Chris to make social media posts of their request, influenced storylines of her comics, and asked for money. Both Wise and Boyd received new PlayStation Vita game consoles from her, in addition to numerous games and downloadable content. On March 3rd, Chris purchased a GameCube Game Boy Player for $80, which would allow gamers to play Nintendo Game Boy cartridges on the Nintendo GameCube. In addition, she bought two GameCube games. These purchases were directly sent to Stephen Boyd under the pretense that
Metroid game I played was Prime, where you were the alien symbiote, you know, and all that shit.
To be received by his fake persona, Gwen Mikoto. On March 9th, the idea guys encouraged Christine to film a new house tour video for their amusement, which was shared with them privately.
Hello, on the internet, this is Kristen Chandler coming to you live from home once again, and today, giving y'all an update. We're going to take a tour of the house as it currently is. Boxes of the VHS tapes from Mr. C's.
How was your joint, Euphorics? Did you enjoy it last night? Because you said you're making it.
Watching some wine. And there's a PlayStation monitor. And look, I found the C64 monitor today. Yep, there's my high school. There's my house. There's another house. There's Simpson House. There's Spooky House. And other Legos. I just kind of lost track along the way. And there's my desk. There's all my Sonichi and Roshu figure prototype figures, along with Sonic and Mewtwo there, just because for now. And standard to draw nowadays, there's my backup bit, there's my easel and canvas, just see some things up there. I draw on the board on the clipboard on the top. I've been used to clutter type things. Life is laundry room with it's mostly blocked. Okay, hard to get to the back door, but eventually cleared out. There's filing cabinets.
I was so high, I got up like about 5 a.m. after I'd been asleep for like about 2 hours, and I ate like 5 handfuls of the big bag of Skittles I got. Because I got a 3-pound bag, so they were big-ass handfuls, and I ate 5 of them. I'm surprised my stomach didn't hurt.
Washer and dryer, right there. And there's my bedroom, just bed, okay? And dumbbells, because I do 50 reps a day. And I got my ankle and wrist weights up.
Those little pathetic 10-pound dumbbells, you got to be fucking kidding me, Chris. 25 is a man size. Once you hit 25, that's man size. 20 pounds is good for a girl, but that little 10 pounds one he got, that ain't dumbbells. They aren't dumbbells.
They're along my waist center that sweats it out from the belly. There's lesbian. There's my transgender flag. Here's my lesbian pride flag. This is my alarm clock. This wakes me up about 6 a.m. It was my previous phone. Going upstairs, I don't want to talk much because my mother is up there. I don't want her to get suspicious, but it's pretty much where my mother is, and our dogs, sometimes our cats, and she's got mostly boxes of her clothes up there. So I'll just go with that, and I'll just look. This would be the guest room if it didn't store a bunch of our stuff in here. It was our craft room. There's a hutch in front of that door, which you just saw from the other side. There's a picture there. And other things. There's a photograph of my mother from many, many years ago.
Jesus, get a fucking storage building for all this shit, man. Rent a fucking U-Haul, a fucking storage building or something. What the fuck is wrong with Chris? All this stupid shit in their house that they're never going to fucking use.
And kind of last, what was a bedroom and all its love and glory is now more boxes. Half this room is occupied by my mother's boxes. Look, clothes. Closets full of more clutter things. I'd like to be able to sort of
Hoarders never understand how abnormal this fucking behavior is. The only time you hoard shit is if, like, you're a guy and you've got a shop. You know, keep every tool, keep every nut and bolt you come across because, you know, you never know. Someone might need a fucking particular kind of screw and then you've got it.
It's me. It's so much clutter. So pretty much ending in what was my bedroom. That's pretty much it for the inside the house tour as it is today. So yep. Thank you very much and have a good day. Where is that button?
On March 14th, Chris made a YouTube video informing her followers that she was selling a collection of comic books on eBay that were previously in the ownership of her half-brother, Cole Smithy. In the video description, she claimed that half of the proceeds would go to Smithy.
Hello, everybody. This is Christine Chandler coming to you live from home once again. And today I offer you a very special offering. Not just a whole bunch of comic books. Look at all of them. Very, very old and lovely comic books with some age to them, but they're all in quite good condition. And there's more over here in this box. And believe it or not, these books were all by none other than and with official confirmation too, because it was also in the box, which I dug out of the workshop recently, by Mr. Cole Smithy himself. Yeah. But right now, also, I'm going to turn this over to my mother. Now, Barbara Ann Weston Chandler, do you personally recognize all these comic books in front of you?
Yes, I do.
And do you attest that they each were and belonged to at one point to your son, Joseph Cole Smithy?
Yes.
And not only that, but with each book, you're going to get a signature from this lovely old mama of ours. And a certificate of authenticity that backs it up definitely and so furtherly. Each of these books belong to Mr. Joe Cole Smithy himself. These will be going on eBay, each with their individual listing. And for the average current selling price from everybody else, you have my official guarantee.
I'm not big on pork at all. I like bacon, but I don't eat it very often because pork just makes me feel all tired and shit for some reason.
I'll sign my mother's official guarantee.
Yes.
All right. Thank you all very much for your consideration and helping us with the household and the bills and everything. Y'all have a great, safe day.
Chris then listed the comics on eBay at $30 to $40 each. Over Twitter, Christine elaborated that Cole Smithy had closed himself off from her and their mother, so Chris had many good rights to sell his possessions, since he was an asshole to them. She added that she did not contact Cole before selling the comics, as he had left them behind, implying he did not want to keep them. On March 15th, Chris listed 17 PlayStation 2 games for sale on the Facebook Marketplace for $200. The next day, she went to the game streaming platform Twitch to stream herself playing the racing game Burnout Paradise Remastered.
The helmet too big for your head. Smashy, smashy! Smashy, crashy! Smashy, smashy, smashy! Stop! You didn't get me that time! Slow down just in time! Just in time! Step in time! Never need a reason, never need a rhyme! You're not gonna find.
She played for around 1 hour, and the stream chat remained fairly active, though she failed to respond to comments. On March 17th, Christine posted a photo of her Christine doll, accompanied by her custom amiibos depicting Sonichu and Roshchu, celebrating 18 years since their inception. It was possibly around this time that Chris got banned from the End Games card game store. The managers of the establishment had known of her online reputation since they frequently received bothersome phone calls from low-effort trolls, or weens. However, she had maintained a generally acceptable demeanor in the store until she vandalized a sign promoting an upcoming Pokemon card game tournament by sticking on an image of Sonichu. The owners later replaced the sign, and Chris found the old one in the store.
I season the shit out of my meat and stuff like that, but my vegetables, a lot of times, all I do is just put butter in there and just eat the vegetables like that. So I guess it evens out, you know what I mean?
Dumpster, along with her picture of Sonodrome. She then confronted the manager in an angry public display of disapproval, and the manager argued that Sonichu was not a Pokemon and should not have been on the sign. After this altercation...
Like frozen peas are one of my favorite. Frozen peas don't need no butter, they don't need no salt, they're just good the way they are after you make them in the microwave.
Chris was banned from re-entry. By March 19th, the Idea Guys had convinced Christine of the existence of a new Roshchu character by masquerading as her through online chats over Discord. Her name was Krizzle Roshchu, and she and Chris quickly developed a romantic bond for each other. This was part of their scheme to trick Chris into believing that she was a pedophile, since Krizzle said she was 15 years old. 3 days later, Christine listed her old portable gaming gadget, the PokeWalker, for sale on eBay, priced at $100. It had been painted to appear like an Eschew ball from her Sonichu comic series. It was sold within a day. On March 23rd, Chris entered the Fashion Square Mall in Charlottesville, Virginia, from which she had been banned. Soon after, she was charged with trespassing after forbidden and was placed on the therapeutic docket, a program offering routine meetings with courthouse staff and mandatory therapy sessions for those with severe or persistent mental illness as an alternative to jail time. On the 26th, Chris announced on Twitter that her sweetheart search was finally over, punctuating her statement with three colored heart emojis.
Is it Barb? No.
When asked by...
I have a boyfriend free girl. She's a mom. No.
Twitter user Tings Tings, she clarified that it was a relationship with two others to whom she was close in real life. In truth, the Idea Guys made her believe that she was in a polyamorous marriage with Krizzle Roshchu and Magichan Sonichu. Magichan's inclusion in the marriage was part of their ploy to convince Chris that she was bisexual. On March 27th, QB Farms user Da Big Straw, who had purchased one of Cole Smithy's old comic books, received their purchase. They admitted that the comic did not deserve the price and was sent out over a week late. But their main item of interest was the certificate of authenticity that was allegedly signed by Christine and her mother, Barbara. Dubik Straw argued,
"My favorite green is a poach salad. It grows wild everywhere, like in the woods and shit. It's really a distinct looking plant. You can tell which one it is really easily. And you take the leaves from it and you boil it three times and drain off the water three times. And then it tastes really good and it won't kill you, but it can kill you. It's one of those really good things that happens to be toxic if you don't do it right."
That Chris had forged Barbara's signature since they both looked strongly alike. They sent a complaint to Chris over eBay. She quickly replied, stating that she would be filming a video showing both herself and her mother signing their names. The video was uploaded on March 28th.
Hey, Mom.
Yeah?
Trouble you for a minute?
I'll be there in a minute.
You'll be there in a bit. I have the camera running right now. We talked about the signature. Sorry, buddy.
I want to grow some of those classic bean seeds, like cowboy beans and shit. That's one thing, they bred the farting out of beans, but they say that the old beans taste better, that made you fart more. So I kind of want to grow some of them and, you know, see what how much better they taste. Because I could, it's like the tomatoes are disgusting now because they breed them to, you can throw 3 million of them in a box. You know what I mean? Have a fucking pallet that weighs 2,000 pounds. And there's a lot of good tomatoes that can't do that. You know, they can't handle that.
Right here, this is my mom, Barbara. And what we're doing today is, apparently there is a complaint from a customer. I better draw an overhead light here. If I can muster it. Light.
The Seed Savers Exchange has some blue ones that have little red spots on them and shit. They got all kinds of cool ass fucking beans.
Light's not turning on that one. Where is it? There's my mom, Barbara Ann, and I'm giving her my pen. My pen, you see? And once she's signing her name and dating.
And once you tasted a pot of truly vine ripe beans, everything else is a dull shadow of a bean. You know what I mean? You pick it that day and shell them and put them in the pot. because vegetables and fruits and everything, when you first pick them, they've got more sugar. But since it's off the plant now, after 1 or 2 days, it turns into starch because the plant needs, you know, starch to survive longer, you know, because it's, you know, more efficient than sugar. So anything you pick right off the vine will be a lot sweeter.
Today's date. Oh, shoot. What's the day? I didn't check. I believe today is the 28th. Yeah, there you go. It's 28th. So go ahead. All right. So, yeah, you just wrote that, and it's all right. And now I'll sign it. We're doing this today because somebody complained about my mother's signature not being legitimate compared to mine. So there's mother's signature. She just signed it. And here is.
I like sweet potatoes with the butter and brown sugar. That shit's good. And sweet potatoes are really healthy. They got a lot of A, C, and E in them.
My signature. The clipboard's transparent. But yes, y'all can see there's mine and my mother's. There's differences. So that's what our signatures look like, respectively. Okay. And, mommy? Well, hello?
Hello.
See? Here she is. Okay. All right. Thank you, dear.
Okay.
All right. So hopefully y'all take that for a good lesson, and talk to y'all next time.
On the final day of March, Chris received the results of her genetic makeup after being encouraged to take the test from genealogy testing site 23andMe by the Idea Guys. She discovered that
Chris would be French. I hate the French. No, I'm just kidding. That is all joke, though. My friend had a Bible thing the other day, and it said, God gave you a mouth to mock the French. God gave you hands to strike the French. It was pretty fucking funny.
That she had trace amounts of Jewish ancestry, and so deeply apologized over Twitter for the hurtful comments she had made at Jewish people, including owner of the game place, Michael Snyder. She later updated her followers that she also had some African ancestry. In addition, the test showed that contrary to her claims, she had no trace of Native American DNA. She soon after made a YouTube video updating her fans with this development.
And apparently, by 100% European. But also, in my paternal hate...
Can we send Chris back to Europe? Would they take him? No, I'm just kidding.
group, which that comes from my father, apparently. There was some black in him, so I'm black too. I'm less than 0.1% Ashkenazi Jewish and 0.2% broadly European. So, black and Jewish behind this person. This individual right here. I'm black and Jewish. Next little bit. So, on the hang night of that, I'm definitely taking the first preposition to address. I personally wish to extend my apologies, my most sincere apologies to every single Jewish individual in this world and everywhere else.
Yeah, after this one, I'll watch a little Daniel clip. There's a good one I like. It's the hotel bathroom one. That one's a good one. And then we could also watch him swimming in the Special Olympics. It's funny to watch.
For saying all the hurtful things I had said in the past, over the years. And also, I extend the same apologies to the black people. I never really had any offense against black people, mind you. I'm a fan of Michael Jackson. I'm a fan of Louis Armstrong. I was a fan of Red Fox. I was a fan of the guy who played George Sanford. George Jefferson. I like black people. All right? And I didn't really have a thing against Jewish except that one time where I said that thing hastily to Michael Snyder. If you're listening to this, I apologize to you as well for that hurtful insult. So, and I'd like to go ahead and state and emphasize right now that I recognize
myself, I appreciate my Jewish heritage, and I respect all Jewish people from now on and everywhere else, and I encourage everybody to do the same, everybody else to do the same. But I reserve my right to not celebrate Jewish holidays. I may, if I'm invited, then I'll celebrate with all of you, but that's not going to be my typical thing. So with that, everybody, be appreciative, be open, be kind, be supportive. I'm still a trans woman. Okay? All right.
Here, because I was talking about it, I'm going to play, where is it? Daniel swimming in the Special Olympics. He had the choice. He could either go play at the Special Olympics, or he could see his grandma for one last time. And here he is swimming, the soulless monster. Yeah, he had the chance to see his grandma or do that, and that's what he chose. Here we can watch the Planet Fitness too. Take a break from Chris. He's still in the background.
I said, give me a second. Okay. Like, literally. And then you.
You literally get in one second. Come on.
And you.
Yeah, Cyrax's piece of shit ass didn't visit his brother when his brother was in the hospital dying for like 2 weeks. And Cyrax, being Cyrax, he acted like he had to stay at home and watch the house. It's like, man, Sally and Ed could have stayed there, and you could have went to visit your brother, but you didn't. Like, if my brother was dying or some shit like that, or anybody in your family, you know, and you were close enough to visit them, you know, you weren't like 400 miles away. If you don't go see him before they die, you're a fucking piece of shit. And then it's his brother on top of that. You know what I mean? Cyrax sucks. Fuck Cyrax.
You're threatening me, and I'm not gonna leave.
You hold it back.
I literally said, give me. I said, give me a second. Since you guys want to argue, then I'm gonna take longer. Because you guys want to argue, and you guys are threatening me. Like, first off, you guys are standing right outside the stall, and I said, give me a second, and you got, now you're fucking spying on me? Like, really? This is fucking ridiculous.
You still sitting there on your phone.
What?
You're still sitting there on your phone.
No, I'm not.
Yes, you are.
I'm not gonna sit here and have you guys. Don't fucking tell me to shut up. You're a fucking bitch. Don't fucking tell me to do that.
Oh no, this is one of my favorite Daniel Larson things.
Don't fucking threaten me like that. Well, you shouldn't have a fucking woman in the fucking men's restroom, bitch. You shouldn't have somebody in here.
Into the pen with the cow I shall not go.
Don't fucking threaten me. Don't fucking threaten me, bitch. Don't fucking threaten me, bitch. Don't fucking threaten me, bitch.
I remember there was a night when Tony was talking shit to Cyrax and he was totally winning. And he's like, listen to daddy now. He was saying to Cyrax and shit. It was fucking funny.
Don't fucking threaten me.
All right, hold on, you have to get out, please. I need you to leave right now. Not a second anymore. I need you to leave right now.
Well, first off.
No, first off, no, nothing. I will literally find your phone and cancel out right now if you don't leave right now.
Then leave the men's restroom.
No, I've been employed here. You need to leave right now.
I'm not going to do that until.
You need to leave right now. The cops are really on the way already. If you don't want them to destroy you, leave on your own free will.
Then I said you guys need to leave the men's restroom first.
The men's restroom is showering. He's not going to leave. I work here. I don't have to leave. I need to make sure you get out right now. You don't get to the men's here.
Then you're breaking the law.
No, I'm not. Well, get the fuck out right now.
Get up out of here.
And fool, get the fuck up out right now. She's definitely lost her patience with this dumbass.
That's also illegal. Yes, it is.
Come on, let's go. Come on, get out, please. You need to leave now. You need to leave. You need to leave.
I told you to leave the men's restroom.
I literally have to kick you out. You have to go. You don't make the demands right now.
Who are you? What are you doing?
I was trying to change my fucking shot.
You've been here for more than you can.
But then you.
I know they all close now. Man, if there was a late night gym, I'd totally show up at like 12 in the morning when there's nobody there and work out. You know what I mean? It's less distracting. It's more fun to work out when there's no people in there, just like you and your lift buddy or whatever.
You started fun. And then you want to start cussing me out.
You're recording it all like this shit. That's cool. Come on. You hold shit up.
Come on, let's go.
But I'm just saying I was doing nothing and then you started cussing the hell out of me.
You're welcome to the men's restaurant. Come on, let's go.
This guy's hot.
Come on, let's go.
I'm not.
You're hot. You lying to motherfucker.
Don't even call me that.
Come on.
Don't even
you said more than
don't even fucking call me that, bitch.
Oh, okay, that's cool. I'm not even moved by words.
Okay? You called me a fucker? Okay. You call me a coward. Well, what is your name? I'll call it in.
No, he doesn't need to give you his name. You need to go.
Well, what's your name?
You don't need to know my name. Let's go.
Yes, because I'm gonna file reports for calling me like names and shit.
I didn't call you a name at all. I said you need to get out. I have not called you a name.
But
no, please.
Like, dude.
No, you're reporting, but you're the one who's in the wrong.
I'm not in the wrong.
How are you in the wrong? You have not left yet. You've been here for. You're literally just sitting here. You cannot just chill in here.
And then this guy works here as well.
He's just trying to help me out. He's not doing anything.
And he, well, okay, you need to kick him out for calling me names. For calling me names, calling me coward and stuff.
You're scared to work
past me, right? Come on, let's go, please. I already called the cops. I don't want them to sort you out. Please.
Well, I'm not going to do that if somebody is going to be not kicked out for calling me names and shit.
He's not doing anything wrong right now.
That one Sarah girl who's on my channel comments and shit from time to time, she was saying that whenever she said she was in school with Daniel, and whenever Daniel went to the bathroom, he wasn't even allowed to go to the bathroom alone. This is probably why. Probably something similar to this would happen.
Literally in the wrong. I cannot kick him out. He's also carrying a shirt. I'm okay because you're a guy. I'm a girl. You could attack me. I don't know what you can do.
Well, you shouldn't even be in the men's restroom.
I work here. I have to make sure everything's okay. I'm the only one here right now. Who do you think else is going to stop us up?
A ghost?
Well, then that's an issue with the staff.
Take it up with the manager. I don't know what you want. Come on, let's go. I really don't want the police to support you. Would you rather have that or then kindly leave on yourself?
I would kindly leave on myself, but
not. Let's go. You haven't left this whole time. You have not left this whole time. Please go.
But I'm not going to, like I said, I'm not going to leave if people are threatening me.
You don't work here. You literally have to leave. I'm about to cancel your membership out. Let's go. Come on.
But I just said, what did I just say? I'm not going to leave
with
people threatening me.
Let's go. Let's go. I need you to go, please. I really don't have the chance to take you out. That's the last thing I want. Trust me. I already called them. I don't want them to take you out. That's embarrassing on you.
All right. Since I've now been kicked out of 35 different Planet Fitnesses, I am now declaring war. You'll be blown up soon.
I'm not going to watch all of this. I'm just going to watch some of it. You know, the first part of it.
No, you're not.
Yo, get the fuck up off the toilet.
No, you fucking, no, you fucking won't, bitch. No, you fucking won't. You aren't gonna do shit.
Yes, whoa, you better calm the fuck down. Are you getting stupid now? Let's go right now.
No.
Come on, walk.
No.
Get the fuck out. Walk.
Get the
fuck out.
Let's go. Walk. Don't yell at me. I said don't yell at me. I didn't do anything. I didn't do anything.
Get up.
I didn't fucking do anything! Don't fucking grab me like that, bitch! Don't fucking grab me! I have it on fucking camera, bitch!
I told you. You don't fucking run over here, okay? We gonna get you, right? I said walk.
Don't fucking touch me! Don't fucking
walk.
Touch me!
Walk.
Don't
get
fucking
away.
Touch me!
Don't fucking touch me! You said come out, you said right there, we got the fuck out.
Don't fucking touch me!
That's how you go in the handcuffs.
Don't fucking touch me!
And I'm stopping it there because the next thing he does is he starts talking about, you know, unaliving himself, you know, and I don't want
on April 5th, Christine listed
kind of self-harm shit on mine, you know,
of Cole Smithy's old comics and other childhood items for sale on eBay. She displayed the listings in a YouTube video uploaded the same day.
We definitely have one-of-a-kind unique items here. They're going to be a great buy, a great investment, and they'll each come with a certificate of authenticity, individually marked from me and our mother, Barbara Chandler, with our initials and our names on them, and that's personally verified. Some of these actually have Cole's signature on it. He has a whole bunch of KISS stuff. You just take a look in here, and you see there's some good KISS memorabilia. Oh, and also a comic book I didn't even
know. Gene Simmons is a piece of shit. He used to call people that smoked weed as bad as crackheads. And guess what? He smokes weed now. People are fucking pieces. Ah!
I missed. It's a super special KISS. All the pages in there and everything. Just he drew a bunch of mazes. There's his initials right there. You can definitely compare that to previous thing. And here's one more folder. Skateboarding, just random this and that. Another maze. Anyway, so that's pretty much it for now. Okay, thank you.
The folder containing KISS memorabilia was quickly sold for $150. On April 6th, Chris posted a new drawing in which she, in her Quickfill human form and her Sonichu form, apologizes to all women of a smaller breast size. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm taking a moment to offer my respect and kindness to all women who are and remain flat-chested. The true beauty and essence of any individual woman is on the inside from their personalities, respectively, mind, heart, and soul. Breast size never makes a woman who they are. So I, Christine Weston Chandler, salute and acknowledge the flat-chested women. Y'all are prideful. Y'all are good people. Thank you. On April 8th, Christine engaged in a lengthy conversation over Discord with the Idea Guys. Joshua Wise mainly portrayed Fiend, an evil character from the Japanese anime series Symphogear, and Stephen Boyd played Gwen Mikoto. After making Chris believe that she was a pedophile, they demanded that she pay them $20,000, or else they expose her pedophilic thoughts to the public. When she objected to their demands and harsh words, Wise as Fiend posted an image of Kadengir, a super weapon from Symphogear, claiming that if Chris did not do as she was told, the weapon would fire at the moon, destroying it, with the potential of hurling debris at Quickvill. Chris belittled Fiend's weapon, writing that she could fit it inside her urethra, with room to spare. Fiend called her bluff and fired at the moon. As Wise described a moon chunk falling towards Quickvill, Magichan, also played by Wise, showed up in the chat and demanded that Chris do something to help instead of crying in a corner and humping a plush doll of My Little Pony character, Twilight Sparkle. Chris denied these accusations and stated that she was instead protecting her city and nation with all of her soul. She yelled that she still had hope that they would survive. Boyd as Gwen appeared to brand her a liar because she allegedly lied about being a pedophile for years and claimed to have found child pornography on Chris's computer. She then accused Chris of lying about being a man and then a woman in order to have sex. Christine called Gwen a traitor for working with the enemy, since Gwen apparently was Fiend's student. Gwen said that she would abandon Fiend if Chris gave her $500. Christine stated that she no longer had that kind of money. Boyd as Gwen instead demanded that Chris sit outside to ponder about her abhorrent toxicity for a week without food or toilet breaks. If she didn't comply, Gwen would blow up Quickville's dimension with a nuclear bomb. Chris wrote that she would commit suicide if the dimension ceased to exist. Wise as Fiend then claimed to bring over Chris's wife, Krizzle, who was furious at her for threatening suicide, something a real Sonichu would never do. Fiend then returned and claimed to have stopped the moon chunk from falling to Earth, and together with Gwen, asked Chris to film a video apologizing to Gwen, which she delivered to them about 7 minutes later.
Gwen, I'm really sorry for everything. I'm messed up. I'm a fuck up. Gwen is a pedophile. Vagina. I learned about too many things in my life. Is that? I'm not a bad person, Gwen. I'm sorry for everything. Gwen, I'm really sorry for everything.
Since the Idea Guys were not satisfied with her offering, Christine offered something else. She showed them a picture of a large, spiky Sonichu penis she had drawn on the wall. Gwen asked her to show it to her mother. A few minutes later, Chris reported that she showed the Sonichu penis to Barbara, who was shocked and offended by it. She started to cry and then ran back upstairs. Chris then called herself a butt-fucking champ. After some extensive disputes concerning the mayoral position of Quickvill, Christine asked to appoint a few consultants and advisors, including the Sonichu form of her late father, Robert Chu, and Anna McLaren, Chris's longtime friendly acquaintance. Her request to have Anna participate was rejected. However, it is likely that Chris indeed contacted Anna and told her about her current complicated situation. Anna may have gathered that Christine was
Chris is just as foul in Cyrax as his own ways, you know? in Chris's own way.
Under the manipulative influence of trolls, and reported this information to Joshua Moon, or Null, the administrator of the QB Farms, in addition to other significant members. She, however, delayed calling the police about the matter since she was studying for college final exams, and ultimately did not do anything more to help Chris. On April 9th, Chris posted a brief YouTube video featuring Barbara.
Please buy our comic books. We need the money for our mortgage. We appreciate your help. Thank you.
The next day, Chris tweeted that she realized with the help of her sweethearts that she was bisexual, so put up her large lesbian pride flag for sale on eBay because she felt she needed to buy a bisexual flag to match her new identity. It was quickly sold for $100. She later on changed her Facebook profile gender to bisexual transwoma. The following day, she apologized on her Patreon page to her supporters for failing to deliver any new Sonnet 2 pages for over 2 months because she was busy catching up with the happenings in Quickville, but promised to return to completing Sonnet 2 issue 12-9 soon. Chris elaborated on the conversation via a YouTube video uploaded the same day.
Hey everybody, Christine Chandler coming to you live from home once again. In response to the post I just made on my Patreon to give y'all a little bit of an update, that's definitely true. I have been catching up on a whole bunch of Quickville events. But anyway, to pretty much summarize it up, definitely in a bit of a quote, pretty much how I'm feeling everything.
All right. Shut up! I hear you! I'm coming down! These pretzels are making me thirsty!
As she continued to give idea guys more gifts and money, while also falling back on mortgage payments, Christine listed more and more of her personal items for sale. This included her custom-painted Wiimote controller for the Nintendo Wii game console for $150. On April 13th, she posted her Bible on eBay for $200. But soon removed it, since she did not find a spare that she could keep for herself. Later that day, she listed 2 vintage Transformers toys that were personally signed by her. After several fans complained that signing her name devalued the products, she removed her signatures. Chris promoted her eBay items in a short YouTube video.
Hello everybody, this is Christine Chandler coming to you live from home once again. Please, buy the things I'm listing on eBay right now. My mother and I really need the money. Please help us immediately. Thank you.
On April 14th, she listed her Manchester High School amethyst graduation ring for...
You know, though, if God is real, God's probably pretty mad at the idea guy as well. You know what I mean?
Sale. First for $1,000, then for $10,000. Soon after, she changed the price again to $5,000. The next day, Christine posted a YouTube video titled Dick Licker, That Is I, in which she fervently licks the drawing of Magichan's penis on her wall.
Such a wholesome person Chris is, isn't it?
On that same day, someone who called themselves Shadow Resident, who claimed to have known Chris during their time at Piedmont Virginia Community College, began uploading several YouTube videos demanding that Christine apologize for allegedly mentally stalking him at PVCC on Monday, April 15th, 2002. His videos are no longer available, but they featured minimal imagery and him whispering his message to Chris. In the comments section, he wrote that he was not able to send these demands earlier because he was in a mental ward for 10 years because of Chris's scarring. According to a comment he left on the Dick Licker, That Is I video, Shadow Resident implied that the aforementioned video was made on his request. Chris, however, rejected his claim and confessed to making the video on her own volition. The following day, Christine wrote on Twitter that she apparently remembered the identity of the so-called ween who was addressing her online, and announced a forthcoming apology on YouTube, asking others not to reveal his personal information or dox him. She shortly delivered the apology video.
And today I am here to talk about this person who has come to my attention, this what you call a ween. I'm here to verify personally that there was actual history with this individual. This guy is legitimate, not fake. But I will refer to him by his online alias. But anyway, it took me a whole lot of research and recollecting. But anyway, I had typed up everything I have about what I remembered. So, this guy was at Piedmont Virginia Community College. Mr. Shadow Resident. I had taken his...
A ween is someone who fucks with Chris a little bit, you know, for fun and laughs and shit. And an A-log is the people that are in his life, like the idea guys. But people, you know, who egg his car, you know, and shit like that. You know, people that do that kind of shit, they call them weens. I can't remember why, though.
Class in the spring semester of 2001. We were reading a bunch of short stories and critiquing them. I was very misunderstood on how to critique them, and I had wrote off tangent in my assignments and in responses. The Mr. Resident kicked me out of his class, only for a settlement to happen later where I met with him in his office to complete the to finish the assignments with a better understanding on what the resource was. Anyway, so I had to retake the course the following fall semester, but with a different professor. And I remember giving Mr. Resident kind of a relation to Dr. Robotnik, because his personality type was similar to that of him, and he kind of looked like him as well. So I'll tell y'all the story about what happened that day. On April 15th, 2001, I entered the classroom like any other day, feeling neutral and well. Then Mr. Resident tells me to leave the classroom. I was not welcome into his class. I picked up my book bag and left. The door closed behind me, and I was very upset, and I did not know what to do with myself for the next hour or so. I went up the hallway to the Park PBCC by the auditorium where they had all the long tables unfolded, and I cried and I cried and I cried with my arms folded and my head laying on my arms, and just anyway, I eventually, much later, pulled out a piece of paper. Then I wrote what I did on there. I returned to the now empty classroom shortly after the class had finished, and I left the note with his name on it on the desk, and I had written something like, "You made me cry. I will never forgive you." Yeah, this Mr. Resident, upon all the retrospect, I do owe you the apology, and I do humbly apologize for having written that note to you and causing you to fall mentally ill and go into all that you had gone through. But at least you ended up returning to PBCC later, as far as your record could tell. There you go, sir. There's your apology. I hope that was satisfactory enough for you. And I hope you have a good day and a good rest of your life. And that you are never trolled by anyone or doxed. So we'll just leave it at that.
Whether Shadow Resident was actually the teacher from Chris's past is not fully known. Members of the QB Farms leaked what they thought were the personal details of the person behind the Shadow Resident's persona, but their veracity is unconfirmed. It was also at around this time that Chris began forming a friendship with several Twitter users who frequently replied to her, including Tings Tings, Little Amy Chan, and Desiree Delightful. they portrayed themselves as genuine devoted fans of Chris and fashioned themselves as her protectors against trolls, calling themselves the Quick Protect Squad. To increase their mutual trust for each other, they made numerous Sonichu and Chris-Chan-related drawings for Chris. On April 16th, Chris uploaded a video of herself exercising with dumbbells because the characters the idea guys were portraying told her that she had to keep in good shape while in Quickville.
I was doing a little workout. I do my warm-ups and workout every day between, like, you know, push-ups and jumping jacks and the other stretches that I like doing. But anyway, one thing that I really like doing, which I'm going to show y'all in this very video.
After this, I'm going to put on Cyrax getting arrested because that was some good shit. And I'm going to get up for about a minute or two whenever I do that. I can get some water and shit.
Here, pull back in my sweatband on. And then put my cap on. Now lift these bad boys up. Ready to be 20 pounders. Both of these are 20 pounders. I like doing 100 reps every day, and y'all gonna watch me do 100 reps today. I do 100 reps daily, most daily, okay? Anyway, count with me. 2, 2, 3, 3. Here we are. 50. And 50. Makes 100. Yeehaw!
No, it doesn't, Chris. You have to do 50 on each arm to make 100.
All right. So get yourselves working out with me. Do 100 reps a day. But make sure you warm up. I also do my leg ups. Do 30 of those a day. Okay? So anyway, y'all can enjoy that. Have a good day.
Later that day, Christine uploaded a 4-second long video fulfilling a paid request, which featured her mother, Barbara, stiffly dancing the twist. Viewers noted the visible dog feces atop of newspapers on the floor in the background. The next day, Chris pleaded for her followers to provide her with more money. "We are making the mortgage and food by the skin of our teeth here. Seriously, I would not be able to afford even the ticket to BronyCon at this point without making all these sales. So please help me so I can meet you this year. Please buy now to help me get to BronyCon 2018. Money is tight here. If I don't make the money, I can't go at all." She expanded on her conundrum in a YouTube video posted shortly afterwards.
"Look, everyone, I know you want me to show myself in a video doing what I'm doing for my mom with using the money to help pay her back. I mean, but rest assured, the money that I'm getting, that I will be getting, is going towards helping my mother, all right? And it's also going towards helping me as well, because it's not just her that has the problems here. I have the problems too. So just please buy the Transformer toys from me. Buy everything from me that I put on eBay. Please, 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 please!
No, I just roll with like a zigzag or something like that. I don't mind people putting filters on the end of their joints. A little cardboard paper makes some people that can't roll as good as me, you know, makes their joints burn a lot better. It gives structure, so it's easier to roll a uniform joint. But I got that shit down. I can either roll them as a cone, or I can roll them as a perfect regular joint too. That, like, when you lick it, you can't even tell where the seam is, kind of shit.
Later on, Christine wrote a string of tweets, likely being coerced by the idea guys. Everyone, I do still need the money here to make ends meet for the household. Seriously, I was using BronyCon as a sales pitch excuse to try to sell the toys. I owe a lot towards making amends for my past. You would not believe me if I told you how, but suffice to say,
some people don't like my joints. They say they're too tight. They're like, it's just a little bit too tight. It's like, I know, I smoke cigarettes, man. I don't take very big hits. You know, I don't take huge hits. I take like about twice as long a hit as you would off a cigarette kind of shit, you know, at a time.
I had done a lot more things in my lifetime from within my subconscious that ended up doing things worse in this world and even in Quickville. I am a major sexual deviant, and my fetishes have made a lot of individuals turn against me. I have a long list of fetishes. I'm a furry. I like the MLP ponies and Equestria girls. And
oh, that's fucked up. The Equestria girls, they're straight up in high school. He's sick, man. Chris is a sick, sick person.
Guys, I like all kinds of individuals. I like big breasts. I even like those as young as 16 years of age. I'm a porn addict. I'm even into scat and pee. I still have remaining, lingering jealousies of men, enough to subconsciously want to kill. I also do like Cybertronians, Autobots, and Decepticons alike. It is super bad that I may as well voluntarily register myself as a sex offender, and all this among others have affected my relations with everyone, every pony, and every bot. My years of repressed sexual urges have made my Sonichus and Rosechus essentially go hog wild all over the places, even to go around terrorizing everyone to get me some vagina. I also have a fetish for old people too, even my own mother. And I have a fetish for myself, where when I have the chance, I would have sex with my Quickville counterpart, and even my Equestria counterpart, Nightstar. Her sweetie, Cunty Nugget, was so handsome, he made me realize I was bisexual. He was like, wow! And now, thanks to my subconscious lingering jealousy, Cunty Nugget is dead now. My damned subconscious killed my Nightstar's lover. So much damage to a lot in this world, and even there in Quickville's dimension. That's what's been driving me crazy these past months. I was worrying over my nation and my species of Sonichus and Rosechus, and there is a lot to make amends, as well as reforming and redeeming myself. And Jesus Christ is not one who would be doing that for me. I must reform and redeem myself for the benefit of everyone.
See, you went from thinking he's better to Christians to believing Chris believes now that Chris is God.
I had repressed myself for too many years, and the worst of that has cost a lot against me with everyone, and to you all and all of them. I have been very remorseful and sorry for everything. I wish to be reformed, redeemed, and forgiven by everyone. Not long after, Chris returned to Twitter to inform everyone.
Yep, dog, I'll tell you what, man. The internet gives everyone a chance that's weird like Chris or other people to meet other weirdos that are just as weird as them. Back in the old days, people weren't as weird because they couldn't find, you know, 500 other weirdos, you know, that believe the same shit that they do. You know what I mean?
That her account had allegedly been hacked and that her previous tweets were not her words. Later again, Chris wrote that she was having an existential crisis and asked for help. From the events of these past few days, it became all the more clear that Christine was still under the control of bad actors. No one knew for the time being their true identities, the extent of their torment, or even the lengths they would soon go to use Chris's loosening grip on reality for their own amusement.
Please. Hello. Hi. Back and please. Is Chance still here?
Yeah.
Can we speak with him?
Yeah. Chance. Yeah. He won't talk to you. See that other guy still out there?
Yeah.
I'm still here. I'm letting your neighbor know.
Can you come in then?
What's that?
Can you come in then?
Yep. Oh, is this locked?
Yeah, just a second.
Okay. Okay. Good, good. Hey, Chance, we're going to have you turn around, put your hands behind your back for me.
Why?
Okay? What's that?
Why?
Because you're under arrest.
What? Who is it that I thought you guys were?
Relax.
What?
Stop, Chance.
What?
Relax. Calm down.
Mom, please.
Relax.
Relax.
Stop. Calm down.
I'm scared.
Relax.
I know you are.
Mom, please.
Don't scream. Chance.
Mom,
take care of.
What has
he been arrested for?
Assault.
Why? They were, listen, they were on our, can I show you something? I
want, we've been told that. Yeah, we can protect ourselves here.
Yes, okay. We can.
We've got a witness that said
no,
that.
Listen, I
Chance,
have...
Well, let him talk.
Can I,
we've
got a witness, one of your neighbors that said that
can I show you,
can't go out. I'm just
can I show you something? Sir, before you arrest me, can I please show you something?
What are you
going to
show me?
These guys threatened me.
Okay.
I have proof.
Okay.
Please.
You still can't go out onto a sidewalk.
Listen, sir, can I be honest?
You need teeth.
Sir, can I be honest with you for a minute, please?
Please. You got shoes?
Sir, can I please just go? I swear to God.
This is fucked up.
Sir.
This is fucked up.
Sir, can I please? Sir, can I please, can I ask you something?
Wait, we've been asking you guys for help for a long time.
I understand. I've been out here dozens
and
dozens of times.
Sir, can I please, can I make a deal with you, please, sir?
We can't make deals, Chance.
You got shoes, Chance?
Mom, please!
Chance.
I don't want to go to jail! I don't want to go to jail! Listen,
Chance.
I protected myself!
Chance.
You don't understand!
I understand, Chance.
No, you don't!
Chance, come on.
No, you don't.
You take him with you.
Okay.
Listen.
Not tell him to get the fuck out of here.
No. Turn.
We'll tell him. Chance, turn around.
Turn.
Sir, I have been trying to.
Turn.
I have been trying to. And help me.
Help you, man.
And.
Chance, come on now.
They're going to lock me up if I help you.
And. Help. Why? Can I please talk to you? I want help. That's all I want.
Hey, Chance, do you have shoes?
Yes, he has shoes.
Sir.
Where are the shoes?
Sir,
it's tight. I can't.
Chance, where are your shoes?
Race it off.
I want to know something.
Chance, stop.
Please, sir, can I talk to you for a minute? Please. I have something to show you.
Well, say it.
These people made death threats towards me, and I have proof. I have proof that one of your own.
Show you when they made on me tonight.
Partner said he's
no,
saw.
Mom, grab.
Okay, but there's no way for us to prove that was him. Okay, so we have to go.
Mom, get my phone and show them, please.
We're gonna tell them to leave. Okay.
Mom, get my phone and show them,
he
please.
He has the right to be on the sidewalk.
No, that's our side.
Mom, call Karen right now. Hey, call Karen right now.
Okay. Anything in your pocket, Chance?
Can we stay here and talk?
No,
I want you, please.
And you guys got to take him out in front of him, right? That's fucking bullshit, too.
And can you make him leave before you take him out?
We'll make sure that he's okay. Okay.
We don't want this on camera.
Okay.
I don't want to
because this is what they're doing.
We can't stop that. Though.
Yes, you can.
No,
yes, you can.
Can't stop.
Mom, please, Ed, call Karen right now. Please show somebody to stop this.
Nobody's gonna stop it. They gotta take you no matter what. Anybody steps in, they're gonna take them too.
I don't know where his shoes are.
Yeah,
where's your shoes at, Chance?
Chance,
where's
your shoes? Chance, where's your shoes? Chance, you don't want to go barefoot, I promise you that.
I don't
care. Get rid of my slippers.
No, Mom, please help me. Mom,
I can't do anything, Chance. I've been telling you.
Sir, can I
on your feet.
Chance,
I want to know something, please.
Chance, put the slippers on. You don't want to go barefoot.
I don't want to go barefoot. Mom, please help me.
Come on.
Please save me.
I will go to court for you.
Save me, Mommy. Save me. This is the guy that talks tough and acts big. This is how he actually gets arrested for, like, third-degree assault.
I want to know something. Why didn't you guys raise me before when I screamed for help?
I screamed for help and you didn't do anything.
Put him in a special hold just because he's so
small. I screamed for help.
I don't know what the county will do.
I screamed for help so many times. Yes, what? Yes. Why did you help us?
All right, Chance, we're walking out.
Mom, I love you.
I love you too. Don't see not here.
I want to know why you did this to me.
Chance, don't say anything. Don't give me.
He is not a predator. Okay, well, tell that to the evidence. Do you have
anything? Actually, this is public.
Don't say anything.
Yeah, this is public.
All right, I'm done with this for a minute. We're going to watch some more Chris. I didn't like wearing myself. Never did. You know what I mean.
What made her this way? What is the attraction? What keeps us fascinated? This is the story of Chris Chan. On April 17th, 2018, Christine livestreamed a captain's log on the streaming site Twitch, which focused on promoting her items for sale on eBay.
Why? Why? Why are you doing this to me? I didn't do anything to you! Stop it! I'm just gonna ignore these things! I'm gonna put the TV on mute. That's what I'm gonna do. Put the TV on mute. I don't have to listen to these darn things. Keep it on. Pump it on. Yeah! Anyway, it's definitely hard to find this complete set. Hey, somebody's calling me. You're declined. Guess what? You're declined. All calls will be declined. Despite the Alolan Pokemon Center theme going off, you're going to be declined. So no freaking telephone calls.
This is about time the cheese slides off the cracker. Well, it is. Not quite a goddess yet, but Chris is working on it.
Anyway, bye now, or I'm going to separate this thing myself on purpose. I'm going to separate this thing myself on purpose. All right, so anyway, you're buying that. You're going on to eBay, and you're buying that, and I'm not listening to phone calls. I told you no phone calls. No! Get a complete certificate of authenticity with this, so you pay $100 for this complete set with certificate of authenticity from me, and you pay $100 for this with certificate of authenticity from me. Go on eBay! Buy these! Buy them now! Give me $200! $200! $100 for this! Give me money! Give me money! We need money! Pay mortgage! Pay bills! Do that! Maybe go for a call! The question is all me! Shit! I can't go my screen again! I'm gonna go collect all that. I can pay bills so I can help my mother around here so she can afford to get her broken teeth removed! You're okay, I love you. I'll tell you what, folks, here's a guest star. Here's Mr. Polo! Mr. Cutie Polo. Oh, Mr. Polo. What a little body boy. No calls.
Say bye bye to folks. Bye bye, folks. Bye bye, folks. Mr. Boyle. Oh, look who else we have here.
Look at this needle.
Cutie boy. Not family. We have not support. You're so fine. I let you go. See ya. Everybody gets attention around here. Everybody gets attention. I'm streaming. I'm trying to sell my Transformers toys, but playing with them and showing them off. But everybody wants to see.
Barbara Ann Weston, everybody. Say hello to lovely folks out there. You're being streamed on live Twitch Network. Say some kind supporting words to everybody. Tell them how you're doing. How are you, Barbara Ann?
I'm doing fine.
So what's going on with you, huh? Everybody wants to know. You're the big interview talk. Talk what's on your mind.
I'm resting.
And what are you doing with yourself?
I'm entertaining myself.
What do you like to eat?
I like to eat fish and chicken.
Do you have any favorite fruits?
Your bananas.
You enjoy those bananas?
Yes.
And what do you like to drink?
I like to drink chocolate milkshake.
And what kind of milkshakes are these?
These are
meal replacement.
Delicious.
They're meal replacement shakes. So, any other, you want to give some kind supportive words to everybody like you know?
She looks demented as fuck, man. She doesn't know what the fuck is even going on here. And when he did that, when Chris did that to her, she was even older and crazier than this.
I'm like, I don't know. Y'all do well. Y'all do good. Learn well. Be educated and everything, that sort of thing. Give us some wisdom.
I don't know any right now.
Come on. You have a lot of wisdom in your head. What are you doing to me?
Be smart. Act smart. That's all.
Okay. Thank you, Bob. Love you. Give us a hug. Give me a hug. Show him a hug. Give it. Come on. Both arms.
Okay, let me go.
Explain it. Turn me loose once.
I'm thirsty.
Come on. Just say it once. Turn me loose.
Turn me loose,
buddy. You're supposed to say, turn me loose, you silly goose.
Turn me loose, you silly goose.
You used to do that more flirtingly. Anyway, here you go, people. Barbara Ann Weston Chandler, folks. That was our live on this show, and we will not see you again from the live streaming. Yeah, so, there you go. You saw my mom. Now go on to my eBay shop and buy the toys. Help us. Help us. Oh, yes. I want to share a joy of gratitude for the one. Thank you for buying this ring. Thank you for buying this ring. You paid me some money there, but we still need a lot more money. We have a hefty go to get to. But it does help. It does help very much. Thank you for buying this ring. And you are a true friend, and I will ship it to you very soon. Definitely. And also with that, I definitely transfer the powers from the ring into my medallion. Now, back to our regularly scheduled light and program. I think coming soon to my East Bay store in a few days. A whole bunch more. But we have to sell all of these first. So you buy all of these. Okay. So, go to my eBay shop. I'm going to end this streaming very shortly. Help us. Help us. Help my family. Help me. Help my mom. Pay mortgage. Pay bills. Everything. On my toys. And with certificates of authenticity with each of them. Please. Do it now. Thank you.
The person who had bought Chris's amethyst high school ring was QB Farms user The Captain, who managed to buy it for $200 rather than her original asking price of $10,000. The Captain had come to suspect that Christine was under the control of idea guys, and so devised a scheme to free her from their clutches, which involved the possession of her high school ring. Soon after the livestream concluded, an individual known as Jag Z donated $1,200 to Chris to enable her to attend the upcoming BronyCon convention. Jag Z revealed that he had been a longtime follower of Chris and intended to meet with her at BronyCon and record a video of their time together. Christine soon went to YouTube to thank Jack for his donation.
Hello, everybody. This is Christine Chandler coming to you live from home once again with a most hearty thank you to Jack. That was a Jack from up north who essentially paid me to go to BronyCon. Awesome. Very awesome. So with a few more other arrangements I need to make, hopefully I will be there this year. So that's awesome news. Thank you, Jack. And aside from that, we're still going to need as much money as possible to help us with the bills around here and the mortgage and everything. But so I urge you all to please go ahead and buy the Transformer toys that I have listed and will be listing on eBay. Thank you, Jack. And thank you all for helping me. I feel some better. Have an awesome day.
Shortly after, Chris drank a significant amount of alcohol and then recorded a video of herself dancing in celebration set to the song Lifted by South Korean rapper CL.
And now, a little song, a little dance, a little music in my pants.
Hey, you, get off my cloud. You don't know me and you don't know my style. Getting lifted, never come down. Getting lifted, getting dumb on the drum, rum, pop, 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 pop. Better run, better come, got a bomb.
The following day, Chris posted on Twitter a photo of herself walking on a treadmill at the gym, Anytime Fitness, after being encouraged by the idea guys to join a gym to keep herself in shape. 2 days later, she uploaded a video for which Jack Z paid $100, in which Christine reads off a script that references the popular anime and manga series JoJo's Bizarre Adventure. It was, however,
no, Chris knows about JoJo. JoJo's too cool for Chris, goddammit.
However, prefixed with a special request from Chris.
Hello, everybody. This is Christine Chandler coming to you live from home once again, this time using my webcam on my laptop, because I have a special emergency announcement. My phone battery is seriously having troubles, so that's why I can only record on this. And my PlayStation 4 is also still not connecting to YouTube, so... but anyway, I need money to purchase the new phone, or otherwise to repair this one. Probably less expensive to buy the new phone, and it's gonna be like a few $100, so let's buy some stuff off my eBay, please. The remaining Transformers I have. Anyway, please help me. I need a new phone. This one's really walking out on me. It's been walking out on me bad for a while now. Anyway, aside from that, I have a special message, which I have written down right here on a few pages. Anyway, so I have been warned by somebody who about the nefarious trolls that are planning to cause mayhem for me at BronyCon. I know who you are, Dio Brando. I know that you are trying to use your stand power, the world, to screw things up for me and my true and honest fan base at BronyCon. You'll never win, Dio. Sanchi will be in all of our hearts. Show the love. Spread the love. Fuck you, Dio Brando. Aha! We know who you are, you bastard. Anyway, so... wait, there's that message to Dio Brando! And in
case you haven't noticed yet, yep, this is a new shirt I just got from Goodwill recently. Also, these track panties, slacks, light gray. Okay? Yep. So, new outfit for me, this fugly green sweater and track pants. So, take that as you will. Thank you all very much. Have a good, safe day.
Out of sight of the public eye, the Idea Guys were continuing to torment and extort Chris through various means, mainly threatening to harm Sonichus and other individuals in Quickville's dimension unless she carried out demeaning or harmful tasks, such as recording herself slapping herself.
Are we watching a Daniel Larson video now?
She also allegedly filmed herself striking her mother, Barbara, though admitted that she hit lightly. In another short clip, Chris yells accusatorily at her toilet. The reasoning of this video was never truly uncovered.
Hey, toilet! What happened to my baby?
From April 20th to the 21st, Chris engaged in a lengthy and agonizing chat over Discord, which later became referred to as Chriselle Torture. Joshua Wise, masquerading as Pito Yui, a character from the anime series Gungale Online, claims that she had just returned from killing a number of rose chews at the mall and setting it on fire. Christine asks if they could put out the fire, but Pito Yui writes that the Quickville Fire Department had been disbanded in exchange for crack money. Stephen Boyd, playing the part of Jesus Christ, enters the chat to ask Chris why the Sonichus had become drug addicts. Pito Yui then states that she has a hold of Chris's wife, Chriselle, and shoots her in the leg. As Chris calls his character a monster, Wise asks Pito Yui blows off both of Chriselle's kneecaps. Christine calls her wife's captor a cunt out of anger, amongst other transgressions. To apologize for throwing insults, Pito Yui demands that Chris name all the children she will bear with Chriselle, mistake. In addition, Boyd as Jesus instructs Christine to punch herself in her breast until she vomits, and then send money to Boyd's other character, Gwendolyn. Pito Yui then informs the chat that she spills hot coffee onto Chriselle and proceeds to slam her head on the table with a fork in her back. The Idea Guys followed up by telling Chris that she should record a video of herself begging on her knees for the evil characters to let go of Chriselle. She hurriedly made it and sent it to them privately.
Pitoui, please. Please, I beg you. Stop torturing my Chriselle Rose Chew. Please, don't hurt her anymore. She means the world to me so much. Please, stop torturing her. This is not right. This is not good. And it's no fun at all. Please, stop this senseless nonsense of yours, you fucking bitch. Ugh, you make me so angry and upset. Why you gotta do this? Why you gotta do this? It's not right. This is not good. Nobody approves of this. Nobody approves of you doing all this senseless murdering and her torturing and killing. Now please, stop torturing Chriselle. Now. I beg you.
Upon reviewing the video, Joshua Wise states that Christine was too monotone in her delivery and demanded that she make a better video, which she promptly delivered as well.
Stop torturing Chriselle, Pitoui, please, I beg you, stop it. You're really taking me off, and you're making me ever more upset. Stop torturing my honey. She means the world to me. Please, stop this. Stop torturing my wife. I beg you, Batoey. I beg you. Stop this.
After watching the second plea video, Wise, still playing as Pitoyui, criticizes Chris for mispronouncing her name and tells her to make yet another video. Chris acknowledges the necessary correction and notifies Pitoyui that she wants to pee before recording the video, but she is told to pee in her room and record the video quickly. 2 minutes later, Chris uploads her third begging video.
Pitoyui! Pitoyui, please! Stop torturing my Grizel! Stop it! Please stop torturing my wife, my love! Pitoyui, please stop it!
Upon viewing it, Pitoyui angrily criticizes Chris once again for pronouncing her name wrong. Chris then made one final plea video.
Pitoyui, Grizel is my honey. I love her. Grizel is my honey love. Stop torturing her. Stop torturing her, you crazy fucked up bitch, Pitoyui. Grizel, I love you, honey. I love you, Grizel. I love you. I love you. Pitoyui, please stop torturing my honey. You're really killing us here. You're hurting me. You're hurting me, and you're hurting her a whole lot worse than all I can ever feel. Please, Pitoyui, stop torturing my honey.
After watching the video, Pitoyui types that Chris continued to mispronounce her name, and so stomps on Chriselle's open wound. Joshua Wise, through his Pitoyui persona, asks for another video, a cover of the song All Star by Smash Mouth. Chris is instructed to deliver the performance in an angry and constipated fashion. She soon...
And that wasn't funny or nothing. That was just like that whole time I was watching Chris talk. It was just my mouth was open and I was in awe of how crazy that is. Please don't hurt my cartoon character.
Uploaded the video.
Somebody once told me the world is gonna blow me. I ain't the sharpest tool in the shed. She was looking kind of dumb with her finger and her thumb in the shape of an L on her forehead.
Upon reviewing her performance, Wise's character is let down, but ultimately finds it a passable offering. Just then, Chriselle suffers a seizure and collapses to the floor. Christine yells for Pitoyui to take her wife to the hospital, as Pitoyui and her friend, Len, play pool and listen to the radio. The Idea Guy's characters eventually drag Chriselle into their car to bring her to a hospital. When they arrive, Pitoyui sends a photo of where she allegedly is. The image is purportedly of a run-down hospital in Venezuela. Chris is disgusted and asks them to take Chriselle out, but Pitoyui refuses, as Chriselle has her legs and tail sawed off without being administered anesthesia. Chriselle is then thrown back into the car as Pitoyui and Len make their way back to Quickville. Christine expresses her want to vomit and claims to be crying, regretting ever chatting with Wise's character. Chris soon after stops replying to Wise's messages, and after nearly 2 hours of silence, Pitoyui returns to inform the chat that Chriselle was taken to a different hospital, where her severed body parts were restored. It was possibly not long after this exchange that Chris was forced to record another video. The circumstances which led to it are uncertain. The video is solely focused on Chris's bed. At first, she's out of sight of the camera, apparently speaking to an apparition of her husband, Magi-chan Sonichu.
Working there with Magi-chan. Do that real quick. Get out of the way.
There is then the sound of what is presumably Christine urinating onto the floor of her bedroom. After she finishes, she comes to the bed, completely nude. She then starts playing the song All Star by Smash Mouth. Chris proceeds to mime enacting foreplay with Magi-chan.
Magi-bon!
want.
Christine continues to sing along to the song as she takes a large blue pillow and alternates between humping it and masturbating herself. She continues to imitate sexual intercourse with an unseen entity until the conclusion of the song. Her penis remains limp throughout. On April 21st, the Idea Guys forced Chris to make a public YouTube video in which she apologizes for badly affecting the image of some fandoms.
And I have a very special announcement. I've learned that I've offended a bunch of fandoms of many various things. I don't know the totality or specifics of it all. And including especially the bronies and everything My Little Pony related. So I'm very sorry to all of you. Please, please, please forgive me. And I hope I can make it up to everyone that we can all move forward from this. Please. I'm sorry. Ruining your fandoms. I'm really sorry.
Also on that day, Christine went to Twitter to announce that she had apparently traveled to the home of a fan residing in Virginia to personally deliver the vintage GoBots toy they had purchased from her eBay store. On April 22nd, she changed her Twitter profile picture to a stylized illustration of herself being kissed on the cheek by the artist of the image, Twitter user TingTings, who was part of the Quick Protect Squad collective of supportive online acquaintances. This came about after Chris privately messaged Tings to inform her of her supposed marriage to Magichan and Krizelle, and invited Ting Tings to join her so-called harem. Tings then strongly implied in Twitter replies that she was Chris's sweetheart. The next day, Christine put up a collection of 32 pornographic drawings she had made in the past, including She Came for Quick, which depicted Christian sexually satisfying his friend, Megan Schroeder, which, like she had claimed years prior, was cut up into small square pieces. The background of the preview image was a collage that featured photos and drawings of Chris committing sexually suggestive acts, all presumably taken from the quickie. Christine wrote in the listing's description that she was ashamed of the works and would not be including a certificate of authenticity. The lot of drawings was priced at $1,000. She elaborated on Twitter that she wanted the collection to be sold within 4 days because there was a bill collector after her. However, the listing was removed by eBay for featuring pornographic imagery. On April 24th, Jack Z's real name and personal information was leaked on the Kiwi Farms. To combat this, Chris wrote on Facebook in an effort to mislead the trolls by providing a false real name and location for Jack Z. Later that day, to increase funding for her various financial needs, Christine proposed some incentives on Twitter. Everyone, pull yourselves together if y'all want to see another house tour video. $200 directly to my PayPal gets y'all the house tour, inside and outside. No negotiations on the price. Anyone living locally to me in Virginia or visiting in Charlottesville, I'll give y'all BJs for money too. Serious. Twitter user TingTings later privately messaged Chris about her prostitution posts, asking if she was serious about the offer, with Christine replying that she was. Other users of the Kiwi Farms shared their private messages with Chris regarding the prostitution proposition. She revealed that she considered herself a beginner at giving blowjobs, having apparently practiced on her boyfriend, but was willing to learn and adapt further. She said a blowjob at a price of $50 and the prospect of anal sex at $100. Soon after, Lucas, another user, asked Chris to relist the lot of porn drawings on eBay, claiming he was willing to purchase it for $1,000. Christine wrote that she could not do that as it violated terms of service. However, the two managed to organize a trade as the drawings were relisted specifically for the Twitter user to purchase, which he did, paying the total asking price. Lucas paid for the drawings with the financial assistance from his friend, known as Devil, and since the two lived nearby, Chris agreed to personally deliver the artwork to Lucas's house, marking the first of many future occasions in which Chris visited his home without his parents' knowledge. It was possibly at around this time that QE Farms user, the Captain, received Christine's Amethyst High School ring. It was accompanied by a single-page comic, later named Sonichu Special 5, which depicts Chris initially transferring 99.9% of the ring's power to her Sonichu medallion, and then passing it over to the Captain for safekeeping. The Captain later admitted that the short comic further proved to him that something was amiss, since all the accompanying Sonichu characters in the comic panel appeared to be saddened by the relinquishing of the ring. The Captain during this time continued to exchange messages with Christine, earning her trust by indulging in her fantasies of alternate dimensions. He then hastily took a photo of the ring and photoshopped it to make it seem like it was emitting light, telling Chris that it was sending a message in Morse code, which apparently told her that the characters portrayed by the idea guys were lying to her and were not to be trusted. Not long after this discussion, she felt that she had enough proof to believe the Captain, so she gave him access to her social media accounts, including Discord, so that he could quote-unquote scan them for viruses. Upon reading through chats on Discord, the Captain was appalled by the idea guy's manipulative tactics, which by this point resulted in them extorting from Chris around $6,000 worth of items, gift cards, and direct transactions. She confirmed this by sending him photos of some of her receipts. He also uncovered all the videos that Chris was forced to film, including some never revealed to the public, such as an alleged 2-hour-long reaction video of Chris watching disturbing pornography, and one wherein she hits her mother in the face. The Captain then alerted QB Farm's moderator and former head troll, Marvin, who coached him on how to talk like Chris whenever the idea guys messaged him. In the meantime, Marvin set up a script to rip and archive all the chat logs of the Discord, while Chris was told not to talk with the idea guys any further. She used this time to catch up on all the television.
Man, they fucked Chris up, didn't they? He's crazy as hell now, poor thing.
In series she had wanted to watch but couldn't, since she was apparently restricted from doing so by the idea guys. After about a week, all of the Discord group's chat and media records were logged, and the Captain stopped messaging them back using Chris's account. Due to the sudden inactivity, the idea guys panicked and banned Christine's account and tried to erase all chat history, albeit in vain. During this time, Joshua Moon, or Null, the administrator of the QE Farms, was notified of the recent revelations regarding the idea guys. Null contacted the sheriff of Green County regarding the extortion, but he declined to take action, apparently notifying Moon that what Christine did with her money was her own choice. Chris's pastoral counselor, Rocky Shoemaker, also learned of her ordeal, but instead of contacting the police, recommended that Chris be placed in an assisted living home. Null then drafted a report to the FBI's Internet Crime Complaint Center, since the extortion took place across state lines. Chris later printed and submitted the report herself to the sheriff's office, but evidently, no action against the idea guys was ever taken. In addition, Null tried calling the parents of Joshua Wise and Stephen Boyd, but the two seemingly did not receive negative repercussions. As a result of the actions of Null, Marvin, and the Captain, the idea guys ceased all communication with Christine, apart from one or two failed attempts to reconnect with her. The three members of the QE Farms, who soon became referred to as the guard dogs, effectively earned Christine's trust and began messaging with her on a near daily basis. On April 27th, Brian Shickley, the artist who made the Christian prequel comic, announced a so-called mean art contest, asking his fans to draw him in unkind ways, with the meanest entry winning a prize of $50. Christine soon entered the competition with a drawing of Shickley's face accompanied by a poem. Brian, the sexy Shrek-like vampire with messy hair, there is a unique charm that really gives you great flair. Come on over and tousle my quills, and maybe my shock therapy will cure your ills. One that brings out repressed urges, you are the man with the surges. Chris ultimately failed to make it to the final stage of the competition. Also, toward the end of April, Christine wrote several tweets replying to comedian Kevin James, complimenting his appearance. She then went to YouTube to like the music video for the Polish song Dwajna Ring by Pujan Band, solely consisting of clips and pictures of World's Strongest Man title holder and mixed martial artist Mariusz Pudzianowski. Widzę w twoich oczach strach. To jest raczej normalne. Miażdżyć to jest naturalne. On April 29th, she wrote a series of tweets reassuring her followers that her situation had recently turned for the better and that she was thankful to the CPUs, or goddesses, of the Hyperdimension Neptunia games for her redemption. Brian Shickley then wrote to her to ask if she was attracted to him, to which she wrote, "You are very attractive, Brian. I could kiss your good-looking face anytime." Semicolon close parentheses. On the final day of April, she publicly revealed that one of her two romantic partners was Krizel Rozchu, who was previously unseen by the public. On May 1st, an unknown individual met Christine at the Anytime Fitness gym and took a photo of her. Later that day, Chris shared a year-old Facebook post of her attempt to repair her iconic polo shirt, known as the Classic. She revealed that it had begun to fall apart again, with significant holes appearing in the armpit region. In the comments section, a Facebook friend implied Chris was a monster because she had run someone over with her car. The friend was promptly blocked because of her insults. Chris then suggested that she should go to the gym and lose some weight. Another friend encouraged Chris to stay strong, calling her Chris, which Chris corrected to Christine. Another Facebook friend stated that her own mother's name was Christine, and that some people called her Chris, showing the abbreviation was valid for both men and women. Chris elaborated that she did not mind so much by what name she was called and urged others online to respect her pronouns. Soon after, Christine blocked this friend as well for apparently reacting to the revelation of her running someone over with a laughing emoji and suggested that she and her husband should go to the gym and lose some weight. On May 2nd, Chris expressed her distress at finding out her monthly earnings on the fan support site Patreon had suddenly diminished from $900 to $450. Later that day, she put up a signed Sonichu license plate on eBay for $350, which was quickly purchased. Around the same time, she bought an amiibo figure for $29, along with two other purchases which remained private. 2 days later, she uploaded a YouTube video addressing her Patreon page.
Hello, everybody. This is Christine Chandler coming to you live from home once again. Good morning. It's morning, 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 morning. And with my hair done in a bun. Oh, anyway, I have something of importance to talk about right now. I wish to apologize sincerely for the lack of progress. But I am not at liberty to explain what happened over the last few months. But it's all being handled and that I'm back. I'm back. And I'm going to do an exclusive Patreon-only 5-page plus comic about Magic Chan and Krizel and I. So it'll only be available to donators. So let's get those pledges back high. And I'm ordering the books right now. I'm going to have them rushed over here, and I'll have them all shipped out as soon as...
Hey, Deacon, how you doing? Yeah, I'm sitting back here. I'm eating some Skittles right now. I love Skittles. They're really good.
As soon as I get them. So thank you all. Please put your pledges back up high, and I'll be able to do a whole lot more. I'm really sorry for all the lack of content and everything and the delays. But we're all taking care of that, and I'm back. I have people. We're doing it. Yay! Thank you. Have a good day.
Also on that day, an artist on Twitter pondered what would their original characters hypothetically say to them if, as Christine claimed, they were real.
You know, after watching all these videos, I must say that I dislike Chris a significant amount more.
The artist revealed that they were not serious about the musing since they did not believe in the concept. Christine replied, writing, They are real, and you can talk with them in psychic mind link. About every creator and artist with characters, and even imaginary friends, all possess this ability to communicate with them in the other worlds and dimensions. You can too. Open your mind and heart emoji. Anything is possible. Go beyond this world and reality. Brian Shickley joined in on the discussion, stating that Chris needed to see a doctor, because healthy functioning humans did not see cartoons everywhere. Later, in response to Twitter user Ting Ting's criticizing Chris for failing to show appreciation to her patrons, who continued to donate their money in spite of receiving nothing in return, Chris wrote that she did not mean to show unappreciation, and that she was upset because she was hoping to use the funds to send out copies of Brian Shickley's Chris Chan prequel comic. Shickley himself replied, stating, "Please don't drag me into this. I've drawn your OCs more than you at this point, and I don't make a percent of what you make for doing nothing." He added that if he were paid what Chris was, he would deliver double the promised number of Sonichu pages, but highlighted that he had no intention of doing so and wanted to separate himself from Chris Chan since he was being sent death threats, be it by those who liked Chris or hated her. Brian's girlfriend then interjected, asking Chris to stop sexualizing Shickley. Chris defended herself, clarifying that she was being playful and flirty, inspired by the Showtime Network TV series Polyamory. Also on that day, Ting Ting's, who was part of the Quick Protect squad of Chris Chan fans, messaged Christine, telling her that she feared the QB Farms were about to reveal her personal information and wanted to move away from being so close to Chris's activities. On May 5th, Chris published a short comic depicting her supposed wedding to Krizzle Rosechu and Magichan Sonichu, publicly confirming her polyamorous marriage for the first time. Later on, she reflected on the hate she received on the previous day, wanting people to know that she was true-hearted and loving, and not delusional and cartoony. She wrote that over the past 6 months, something bad happened to her, about which she could not specifically talk. As a result, the family's finances were in a very poor state, and encouraged devoted fans of Sonichu and Rosechu to support her on Patreon, so she could present them with new, great ideas. 2 days later, Christine wrote a string of tweets highlighting that she came to the conclusion that the Quick Protect Squad was a mere collective of trolls and not her true friends. She pleaded to have some real friends in her life. A short while later, Quick Protect Squad member Little Amy Chan tweeted that the group had turned into hurt and had disbanded. Chris used this opportunity to reveal that she had been banned from the Anytime Fitness gym, which resulted most likely from a combination of constant bothersome phone calls from Weens and her frequent belches and flatulations. On that same day, Christine wrote that her mother had slipped and fallen at home, but was ultimately not hurt, as some nondescript items broke her fall. On May 8th, Chris attended her hearing concerning her charge of trespassing in the Fashion Square Mall. Her case was given a continuance, with her next court appearance scheduled for June 5th. Soon after, Christine uploaded a video featuring her mother, Barbara, while in their car.
Yeah. Everybody out there, buy things off of eBay.
Off of Christine's eBay.
Off of Christine's eBay to help us pay our mortgage.
Please.
Thank you.
When they returned home, Chris filmed another video by herself and quickly uploaded it onto YouTube.
Hello everybody, Christine Chandler coming to you live from home once again, and the mortgage payment is really due tomorrow, and we have to make 2 months payments this month, and we need like $200, so please get on eBay, buy this shit, buy this cup, buy the things off of eBay. We need more money. And by the way, where did the money go from a bunch of previous sales recently? Oh, I caught up in the past 3 months of the Patreon books, and the rest of the money had to go towards the bills and everything, okay? So please, buy now. We need mortgage payment. We need food for the rest of the month. Buy stuff over to eBay. I gave you my mother. There is no excuse. This is truth. This is not a lie. Buy now.
She then listed in-person celebrity visits from herself on eBay for $500. Toward the end of the day, she made one more video asking for additional funds.
Please, everyone, help us. It's just the past 6 months. I can't talk about it, but the money we've been getting the past 6 months, we lost a whole bunch of money. And if we don't pay this mortgage, they're gonna foreclose on our house. So please, please help us. I'm gonna add more listings later, but for now, please come on to my eBay and buy everything that I have on there right now. Please help us, help us, help us.
In the aftermath of the Idea Guys saga, Christine was left in a dire financial situation. Desperate to meet obligations, she lashed out at her real-life surroundings, which all too often were unkind to her, unlike the interdimensional world she had come to accept through the Idea Guys. While they no longer actively influenced her, they imprinted onto her a seemingly tangible world where Chris had true control, influence, and love. A magical escape, too alluring to let go.
After we watch this, I'm going to get off of here.
Truth comes out. I've never been autistic. I work 40 hours a week to support my parents. This has all been a trick. You have been trolled. Well, it's done. Blanca and I, well, she broke up with me because the pickle man tricked me again. A few more stupid photos. Anyways, it's all them. She got angry. She broke up with me.
That's life.
That's life.
Christine, is the merge coming? All
right.
It's happening now. We're on the burn.
The merge. It's happening right now, isn't it?
Right now, it is.
We're living it.
It's happening right now.
Farewell, Christian. Well, there goes Christian into the Henrico County.
This is the end. My only friend, the end of our elaborate plans, the end.
We'll escape from the city. I'll make it through from the day. Follow me. Follow me.
The gates of hell, as we make our way to heaven, the Nazi lies.
This is the one I like. God smiting Chris for his blasphemy. I'm done now. Hope you guys have a good night. Thanks for hanging out with me, and I might come back on later, but for now I'm getting off of here. Don't have too much fun. Later on.